Well, good evening and welcome to a special meeting of the Federal Way City Council. Would you all please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance, and would State Representative Linda Kochmar please lead us in the state in the pledge?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Would you all please remain standing? For 30 seconds, would you let's honor the fallen victims and honor our community in a moment of silence, please. Thank you. Please be seated. Well, this is truly a historic turnout. I'm your mayor. My name is Jim Farrell. We've got our council members here. This is a very important meeting. We've got an agenda that we had at the front door, but let me just explain to you what how this is going to roll out, and I'd just like to make a couple comments before we get started. First, we're going to start off with a presentation, a public safety presentation by the Chief of Police, Andy Wong. And he'll have a PowerPoint presentation, and he will introduce his team. The most important part of the evening is to hear from you, the citizen, comment, and we're going to get to absolutely as many comments as possible. If you would like to speak, please fill out a pink sheet or whatever sheets. Do we have them back there? And for those actually watching this remotely in other rooms, if you care to, we'll do this as well. We will facilitate comments, so please fill that out. Right now, I've only got 12 comment sheets. So if we, at some point, normally we allow for 3 minutes. If we get to a point where we get quite a number, we may need to cut back the 3 minute time to where we can facilitate as many people speaking as possible. You know, this is obviously what has brought us all here together as a community is obviously a very important thing to hear from you. These are tragic events. We want to hear from you. It's absolutely important. And but I also want to say that our police chief will outline our plan. I want to pledge to you as your mayor that we will rest absolutely no resource to find those responsible for these crimes, that we will do absolutely everything we can to make sure that this is a safe community, that people can go out at night, and that we need to make sure that moving forward that people are not able to commit these sort of senseless crimes. And so we'll have a good discussion tonight. But I also want to say one thing. I know that we are all here because we care about this community. We care about our neighbors and our families and our friends. And let's keep that in mind when you're giving your comments. Some of this is obviously very, very emotional. And what we want to do is make sure that we're able to communicate in a respectful way and make sure that the council and I are able and the staff here are able to take your comments and use them to help our city and our community. So with that in mind, let's go ahead and start off with a presentation by our Chief of Police, Andy Wong. Chief?
Mayor Farrell, Deputy Mayor Burbidge, members of the council, I'd like to first introduce some key members within the police department that has provided exceptional leadership during this week. First to my left is Kathy Schrock. She's our civilian operations manager. She's the highest ranking civilian staff within the police department and oversees most of the civilian staff within the agency. Next is Deputy Chief Steve Neal. He oversees a support service division and criminal investigation section. Next to him is Commander Brett Hatfield. He is the mission commander to execute the plans we have put in place. And then next to Brett is Deputy Chief Kyle Sumter. He is our Field Operations Division Deputy Chief. Tonight, we'll be sharing some information with you, crime information, and strategies and tactics that have been implemented to impact gun crimes in our community. When you look at Federal Way crime rate over time, It is not a dangerous community when comparing to other urban cities of this size. However, This is a moment in time that we should be extra alert, be aware of our surroundings. I am confident that if we work together and support each other, we will restore our community to being safe again. This week, we had a very unusual occurrence. We had 3 homicides in a very short span of time. I would like to share some information with you about these incidents and also some of the precautions that our citizens can take. On Monday, May 9th, at 1:01 a.m., officers were dispatched to an apartment complex at 1300 Southwest Campus Drive for someone who had been shot. Male victim, 26 years old, succumbed to his gunshot wound. On Monday, May 9th, same day, 11:27 p.m., officers were dispatched to a man slumped over a wheel in a parked vehicle located at 2200 block of South 333rd Street. Male victim, 27 years old, was found deceased. He had been shot. The following day, on Tuesday, May 10th, at 11:12 p.m., officers were dispatched to a shots fired call. Officers arrived and found a male victim, 30 years old, lying on the sidewalk with gunshot wounds. Officers and firefighters performed life-saving measures, but he succumbed to his injuries. These are the 3 locations. The first homicide took place here, 1300 Southwest Campus Drive, at an apartment complex. The second homicide was on South 333rd Street, next to an apartment complex at that location. And the third crime occurred on Southwest 356th Street and 18th Avenue Southwest, just on the city limits of Federal Way. We recommend residents take extra safety precautions while we investigate these crimes. We're asking citizens to avoid going out on foot late at night in secluded areas. When you're in the dark, try to be in groups. The more people that you have with you, the safer you are. We're asking our citizens, if you see something suspicious, circumstance or a person, please call 911. We were relying on citizens to be the eyes and ears in our community. Although none of these crimes involve a home invasion, we're asking our citizens to be vigilant, lock doors, lock the garage door, even when you're home. I want to share with you our overall crime numbers for the past 4 years. When you look at our crime numbers, last 2 years, we had crime reduction of 1% in 2014, and overall crime reduction of 5% in 2015. And then you have the crime rate per capita listed below. And last year was 99.4, with a population of 90,760. And we believe the population is probably higher than that. Generally, we experience maybe 3-4 homicides a year. The highest homicide rate we've had in our city in our 20-year history is 9. And after May 11th this year, we've had 5 homicides. And on Monday and Tuesday, we had 3 homicides within a very short span of time. When you look at the 3 violent crimes of homicide, robbery, and aggravated assault, it's relatively flat, just up by 2 when you look at first quarter of 2015 and first quarter of 2015 versus 2016. What is different this year is that we have seen a significant uptick in gun violence within that aggravated assault. Here's crime statistics involving firearms. As far as drive-by shootings, after first quarter of this year, we've had 5. I do want to note that Starting June of 2015, we required all our officers to document any and all confirmed shootings. An assault with firearm doesn't necessarily mean a discharge. Any time a firearm is involved in committing a crime is listed. And after first quarter of this year, we have 11. And the numbers above are annual numbers there. So you can clearly see that, there is an uptick. And homicide by firearm, we are, after first quarter, we're at 1, but now we're at 4 year to date. And then the illegal discharge numbers at 7 after the first quarter. Here's a surrounding jurisdiction comparison for a number of homicides in 2015. And then drive-by shootings. Last year we had 6, and Tacoma, 114, and other jurisdictions do not track drive-by shootings. So the information was not available. So as a police department, what are we doing? One, we've made media notification with each incident in order to inform the public. And after the third homicide, we felt it was necessary to call a press conference and to alert our citizens, particularly after the third homicide, when we learned that it appeared to be a random homicide. Most homicides, people are engaging in risky lifestyle. In this situation, the victim was a complete innocent citizen, a model citizen, was out jogging with his dog, training for a marathon when he was shot and killed. At that moment, we felt it was necessary to alert our citizens to be safe out there. In the immediate time, I did ask our citizens not to go out in the evening. Wasn't sure what we had. 2, prioritize all our resources to capture these offenders. We have reorganized, restructured. It is the highest priority of this police department and this city to apprehend these individuals and hold them accountable for these senseless crimes. We have reallocated personnel to increase staffing and detectives to assist the number of detectives that are working there. We retasked our uniformed personnel to focus on reducing crime. On Tuesday, we held an all-supervisory meeting, and we are all moving in the same direction of combating these gun-related crimes. We're using crime analysis data to communicate that to the field units in the field, to specific locations. I want to just briefly talk about our ongoing juvenile delinquency program. These programs are meant to mentor, coach, and spend time with our youth in our community. I won't talk about any specifics, but we have a robust program. We partner with other organizations to do that. One of the areas is this summer, we had scheduled to have a youth police academy for our high school students, and we'll be doing that this summer. We're partnering with the federal and state law enforcement agencies to look at ballistic evidence, to draw connections with other jurisdictions. We're partnering with local, state, federal law enforcement agencies and to help our detective unit investigate this crime. We're partnering with the King County Prosecutor's Office. They are, a prosecutor's been signed to each one of the homicide investigation. We are working hand in hand with them, looking at everything. And to identify, we're gonna prosecute these violent offenders. We also partner with Suburban King County Coordinating Council on Gangs. It's a multi-jurisdictional coordinated response to youth violence in our suburban communities. We're also partnered with Public Health, Safe Storage, Save Lives campaign. In 2012, $4.5 million in value of firearm was stolen in the state of Washington. Unfortunately, many of those guns are in the wrong hands. And guns in the hands of teenagers are the most dangerous offenders. Multifamily housing organizations, partnering with them. And then we're asking our citizens if they want to partner with us to sign up on our Safe City Federal Way, FW.com. A reward is being offered. Puget Sound Crime Stoppers is offering $1,000. We have an anonymous donor that next week the award will be combining the $5,000 anonymous donation, and that'll be a $6,000 reward for leading to the arrest and apprehension of these individuals. On behalf of the police department, our deepest sympathies go out to the families and loved ones who've been directly impacted by these crimes. Please know that there is nothing more important to the men and women of the Federal Way Police Department to solve these crimes and bring closure for the families and for our community. I couldn't be more proud of the men and women of the Federal Way Police Department. They are working day and night to solve this crime for our citizens. Thank you.
Thank you. So we're going to move into public comment at this point, and Council, if you've got individual questions or follow-up with the Chief, we can do that when we conclude citizen comment, when we get to the City Council discussion on public safety. So first we've got Heidi Gutierrez. Heidi. And then Javier. Heidi, come on. Yes, yes, sir.
Adam was my son. He was a very loving, kind individual. There was no reason for this to happen to him. He was not involved in any illegal or anything that he shouldn't be. He was a UW student. He was a veteran of the U.S. Navy. He was on the U.S.
Nimitz. Eric, Peter Roosevelt.
You did 9 years. He was an exceptional individual. And I just don't want this to become a gun issue. I have nothing, nor does my family have anything against guns. We don't own any of our guns ourselves. But I do not want this to become a gun issue, because this is not a gun issue. This is a people issue and a mental health issue and an evil issue. Okay? It has nothing to do that gun. I don't have anything left to say, except that he was the sweetest person you'd ever meet.
God bless you.
Thank you.
We have a problem with one killer out there shooting me, and there seems to be a habit, but no one's paying attention. It could be a rogue cop.
Javier, I'm sorry to interrupt. Javier, did you? Heidi, thank you so much. Our words cannot even begin to touch what you're experiencing, but Javier, did you have anything you wanted to say?
I have a lot to say, but you know, we could only.
It's okay. Go ahead.
Again, to reiterate what my wife just said, you know, he was an exceptional man. You know, after he left the Navy, he was going to UW, becoming an electrical engineer. He served as a nuclear engineer in the Navy. Aircraft carriers, the 190. He's a very sharp man. He and his wife, he was waiting for her to graduate in 14 months in order for him and his wife to start a family, because he was responsible enough not to get over his head on things. Skips a generation, that was from my dad's side. You know. Anyway. We have an evil problem in our community. And I like your little signs that say safe right away. We've been here we lived here. I've come from Los Angeles originally since 82, because I was in the service, in the Coast Guard and in the Navy. Did serve in Iraq, and I was one of the icebreakers here. when I got here, it was a, this area was a beautiful community and whatnot. Now, in the last few years, that we lived in Federal Way for 20 years now, 23 years, the last few years, we've been noticing a little evil going on in our neighborhoods, crime coming up, and if, again, if as citizens, we don't get together, we could go back and watch TV and go, you know, and say, oh, poor to the next guy. But when it hits you, and if we don't get involved in our community, it's going to happen to somebody else. And there's going to be more tears shed. I'm not a public speaker. This is tough for me to be here, but it's tougher for me to lose my son. Thank you.
I want to invite all of you tomorrow night. We're going to have a vigil for Adam at the site where he was shot on 356th and 18th Southwest. So please come show your support.
Heidi, what time?
It will be at 8 o'clock.
8 o'clock at night?
Right. Yes.
Thank you. All right. Thank you, Javier. Thank you, Heidi. All right. Cindy Jarvis.
First, I want to express my sympathy and heartbreak for this family and for their loss. I love Federal Way, and I would like to propose that there be a change of agenda, and that there be a change of agenda now. I would like to see us put a freeze on the Performing Arts Center and direct those funds. Direct funds to strengthening this police force. I believe they do a wonderful job for our community, but they are short-handed and our problems continue to escalate, and we need to give them resources. Freeze it for just a time until we can get Federal Way to be a safe place again. Who's going to want to come to performing arts and events when people, good people, are shot in our community? So I would ask you, please, to reevaluate, take this opportunity to change the agenda, put police and safety first for all of us, for our children, for our grandchildren, for our community, for our schools. We have an excellent school superintendent now, but with a mess like this, we need this to be the safest place. Thank you very much.
Scott Angel, and then Matthew Jarvis.
Thank you for the time. First of all, our condolences to the family. It's rough when anybody loses a child, especially one so exceptional. The family and Cindy have already kind of said some of the things I wanted to hit on, and I wanted to bring up something that our police chief brought up, and that's that, you know, getting the community involved and working together. And quite honestly, I think that, you know, a lot of the programs you guys have come up with, the youth program, the, you know, junior police academy, great ideas. But what about the rest of us that are adults? Some of us are trained. Some of us, you know, we can actually make a difference and do something. What can we do to help? And that's what I want to know. I want to, you know, our homeowners association, if you're not part of it, is already part of the Safe City program. It's a good idea, but what do we have to do to expand it, you know, and really bring this community together? Because that's what we need to do. We've lived here since 2010 when I got stationed here, and we love this city. It's beautiful, and if you pay attention to real estate, it's coming back up, and let's keep it going that way. Let's keep it beautiful, and you know, let us know what we can do to get in front of this so nobody else has to go through what this family's gone through. So, thank you.
Thank you, Scott. Thanks, Scott. Matthew Jarvis.
Fellow citizens, for years we have heard lip service about public safety, and yet people die in our streets. The murder that was not a friend of mine or someone I knew happened blocks from my house. And we get lip service about public safety, and we see tens of millions of dollars being spent on pet projects. The city of Everett, which is nearly the same size as Federway, slightly larger, has 200 budgeted police officers. Federway has 130. Do you want to know why we have a crime problem? Because our priorities are wrong. Time for action, not talk. Thank you all for coming here. To that end, the chief mentioned the donation. My family personally donated that $5,000 because we're committed to action in Federway, not talk. I hope they find your son's killers, the killers that have been ravaged our community. It is time for action, not time for talk.
Yeah. Margaret Jordan.
I'm not a public speaker either, so y'all just forgive me. But I would like to also offer my condolences, and I'd like to thank the police for everything that they do. I do have a question about, I've only lived here almost 4 years, and I've seen the quality of life go down considerably since I've lived here. I think there's way too much Section 8 housing and all that's being built. The other night, we had a representative from the police department come to our homeowners association meeting. We were told that over by Lowe's, that new complex at Section 8 over there has a minimum of 40 police calls a month.
Yes.
The new one by Multi-Service Center has a minimum of 20 calls, and it's not even half full yet. And you've got this on 320th that is zoned for public Section 8 housing. We are the dumping ground for this, and there's no excuse for this. And I have decided to leave the community, and we are leaving this summer. We have decided that the quality of life just is not good for us, and we're moving on. So I feel bad, but I wanted to come here and say that I'm fed up and I'm disgusted with the way that this has been handled. And y'all need to really get a handle on getting quality homeowners and taxpayers instead of becoming the dumping ground for all the Section 8 people around. I work with the homeless. I've worked with Fusion and other programs, and I'm really want to help people, but I also am a homeowner taxpayer, and I want to feel safe in my home, and I don't now.
All right. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Margaret. Fred Cranin. Fred? Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Fred put in a comment that I'm supposed to read, and it says, "My grandson was murdered last night, and I want to know what you're doing about this." I'm sorry, Fred. Thank you very much for your comments tonight. Susan Totti or Tui. Sorry. Thanks, Susan.
I also would like to express my condolences to your family. I cannot imagine what you're going through. And to thank our brave and courageous police officers who go into these that go into these situations, and they do protect us, but they need more help. And so I would agree with the idea of expanding our police force. And I have mine's kind of a question statement as well. And I volunteer with two organizations that help the homeless in our community. And so I'm not a totally heartless person, but when I drive into our community, and the first thing I see is people, young people primarily, with signs on every corner, it's a terrible representation of our community. These individuals, sometimes they're in a group, and they take turns holding the signs while the others sit around and munch on snacks that I guess they've purchased with the money that people have given them. Or they're stationed on every corner, so they catch people coming from every direction.
Women and children.
Yes. And that's true. They yes. Sometimes it is families, and it's a child on a corner is a very dangerous situation, running, you know, sitting, running, whatever. It's just, it's a dangerous situation. Some driver is going to be, you know, have an accident and not be able to cope with the consequences of that, that they have to live with. But I guess my question is, what are the city ordinances, or what is the ability of the city to curtail this? Because it's out of control, mm-hmm. and it's... So are you able to answer that?
I can. You know, I was a prosecutor for 19 years. We also have our city attorney here. Whatever time is remaining, maybe we can, Stephanie, maybe we can stop her clock or just pause it real quickly. We, the council and the city, have taken a look at this and amended our statute on multiple occasions. Actually, our anti-begging ordinance actually got overruled at the Court of Appeals at one point because we tried to take it to a tougher level. It is constitutionally protected speech to stand on a street corner and ask for money. What we have done as a council and said is make sure that we have said, you know, you can't impede traffic, you can't get out into the traffic lanes. We've curtailed the distance between ATM. It's a very, very fine line between a begging and a robbery that occurs by someone's car, by an ATM machine. So this council repeatedly has been taking a look at getting as close to that constitutional line as we possibly can. So it's something that we are looking at. But I can tell you that the conversations that we as a council, that the council has had, that I've had with them and we've had with the council, or with our legal counsel, is zeroed in on the exploitation of the children. We've all seen it. We know exactly what's going on. It's horrible, and it's something that we'll be talking, you know, the council will be talking about addressing that particular issue. But ultimately, though, it is constitutionally protected free speech to stand on a street corner and hold those signs up. And so somewhere along those lines, we've got to create that balance. And I don't know, council, Amy, you guys, Amy Jo is our, you guys, hold on. Amy Jo is our legal counsel. Amy Jo, anything to add to that?
No, just that we're continuing to look at it. Every city is dealing with this issue. We're always observing, trying to come up with new ideas, but we are battling the Constitution. So we're doing everything we can without violating people's rights.
But Susan, it's the exploitation of the minors that I think I've had conversations with every council member on this dais about that deplorable act. And so that's something that we can address as well.
Well, it is a danger, and I understand, too, with homeless families that keeping your children in school is an incredible challenge. But you also see school-aged children out there as well. And it's, you know, that's not the way to build a community either. So I appreciate your concern for it and your continued efforts.
Thank you, Susan. Since we've started this meeting, I've actually gotten word that we have yet another anonymous donor providing $5,000 for the apprehension. Let's give them a big round of applause. That'll take it up to $11,000 and really send the message that we are absolutely serious. Gerald McLaughlin, President, Puget Sound Crime Stoppers. And Gerald, before you get started, you guys, just to make sure we go a little bit faster, because I want to make sure everybody that wants to speak can. We've got Kathleen Dimer, Richard Rainey, and Melinda Ruiz. So if you could just be ready on deck. Go ahead, sir.
To take nothing away from the events here, clearly there's other issues that deal with and address. Crime Stoppers of Puget Sound, I'm actually the president for four counties, King County being the largest. We have Kitsap, we have Snohomish County and Island County. But I'm also emotionally connected to Federal Way, grew up here, went to every school just about in this county or in this town, graduated from here and moved away, and a couple years moved back because of all the reasons, centrally located, convenience. Had to drag my wife back to it because she wasn't a fan of coming back to it. We were used to living in a rural part of area, but it was a heck of a drive. I'm saying that because I came back to walk and to get comfortable and become back of my old citizen. And I'm an overweight guy, but I actually walk from Milton all the way back down to Marine Hills. I walked from one side of Federal Way to get in shape and ride a bike. This ain't the town I grew up in as a kid. I'm speaking as Crime Stoppers, but I'm saying I'm also a resident. So I came tonight on both sides, and that is the money that comes through, we don't have to wait till next week. As the president of the board, I give you my word, we will approve that money regardless of whether it's ready or not. Crime Stoppers is a nonprofit organization. What's important is you still can use your Safe City programs, but coming through us, you don't have to be afraid. That's why I got involved. Too many of us shut up and don't say anything for fear, which we have the right to be. We want to do the right thing, but we're afraid no matter what. I sit in this movie theater at times going, good God, do I really want to go to that theater or not? It's comfortable, but do I really want to go there or not? It's sure convenient, but do I really want to go there? Do I really want to take my grandkids there? Yes, it's my town. There's an Eric Church song that says it's my town, and I move back to my town. So Crime Stoppers is saying, when you pick up that phone and you call, not just for this crime, but this is our focus, but for any crime, if it rattles and we take back our streets, the police are not our issue. We all get that. That's who we see. That's who we talk to. So that's our frustration. The judicial system, the system across the board, will not take the problem out fast enough, but you still got to keep calling. You still got to actively be picking up that phone. And if it's a 1-888-222-TIPS number and that gets in, we pay out the rewards up to $1,000. In this case, we will pay out the extra money for this crime. Not for other crimes. It will be for this crime. And it's not to convicting them. It's to leading to the arrest to get animals off the streets who don't belong around the rest of us. I'm not politically correct. That is why we're involved. I don't have to move from my neighborhood because I'm unsafe. I got to take back my neighborhood to make it safe. Pick up the phone. Please feel free to call us. It is 100% anonymous. Most of all, this is why I'm stressing this. If you go through a normal legal process, your name due to public records is out there, and that's what scares many people. Even if you don't accept the tip, when you call 1-800-2-TIPS, we do not have to give up, and we will not give up any information. We don't even know who we're paying that tip to. It is 100% anonymous. It goes to the bank. That person picks it up. Why? Because bad people tell on bad people. Good people just call in because it's the right thing to do. But bad people will tell on an old boyfriend, somebody to get even with them. And when you people put up the kind of money you just did, you buy a lot of solutions to help law enforcement. I'm saying it passionately. As a group, chip in your money if you really want to do something, whatever you want to do, but help take these people off and send a message that we're not willing to tolerate it, and Crime Stoppers is willing to help in any way we can.
Thank you, Gerald. Kathleen Dimer. Kathleen? Kathleen Dimer? Oh, there you are. All right. And then Richard Paynes or Rainey? And then Melinda Ruiz.
My name is Kathleen Dines, and I'm here to say I'm proud that people have put up money for this reward, but I suggest the city put up at least $25,000 for a reward because these people will come out of the walls to get money. And I am very fearful of our children that have guns. I know this sounds, I don't know whether it sounds weird or what, but I think our schools need to have metal detectors in every door that our children go through. We have 14-year-olds in school carrying guns in their backpacks. We don't know if that gun's going to go off accidentally or if they're going to get mad at a person in the play yard and pull it out and shoot them. We don't know that. And another thing I'm worried about, all this affordable care housing. Do we mandate that they have security officers in and around their buildings, and how many? And when you apply for Section 8 and you go into these affordable care houses, are people vetted? Do we know how many guns they're bringing into these apartments? The people that rent these apartments, do they ask, do you have a gun? Do you have a concealed weapon permit? I'd like to know that. because I want to feel safe in this community. I've lived here for 7 years, and sometimes I'm afraid to go to the movie theater because I don't know. And one time I turned in a man who scared me going into the movie theater, and I said, you sell him a ticket, I'm not going in. And they didn't sell him a ticket. So I'm just saying there's some radical things that I've said, but I think our schools need to protect our children from guns, and this community is too full of guns.
All right, thank you, Kathleen. In regard to the, just real quickly, on the Section 8 housing, everyone that gets a place there has to go through a criminal background check. But Chief, do you know if they are required to have active security? I know you deal, our police force deals with those folks. Chief?
The new apartment complexes are going in. They don't have 24-hour security, just selected hours, usually evening hours into early morning is when they have security on duty.
Right. Thank you, Chief. Richard Rains, sir. And then Melinda Ruiz.
I am friends of Heidi and Hobbs, and I will say that I feel their pain. And I know that you people here feel their pain. And it's unmanageable. I can't even fathom what that would be like. This city lost an incredible young man, and that's really tragic. And how many is it going to take before something's done? What I would like to say is, now that we have this high-density housing, what is the plan to manage it? What are we going to do to manage it? I understand that we're just going to partner with some of these agencies now. Why are we not partnering with them on an ongoing basis? King County, State Patrol. I want to hear plans. I don't want to hear temporary solutions that we're going to increase patrols. I want to hear specifics, and I want to hear timelines. None of this means anything to Heidi and Hobb and the Gutierrez family. It doesn't mean anything. Give us specifics. We deserve that. Adam deserves that. Look into their eyes. Feel their pain. Thank you.
All right, thank you. And when we're done with the question and answer, when we're done with the citizen comment, we're going to follow up with a couple of comments, but I want to make sure we keep this going. Melinda?
First of all, I want to say my prayers go out to all of the victims, and especially you, and thank you for coming tonight to share your love for your son. My name is Melinda, and I've been a resident in Federal Way all but 2 years of my life. I didn't want to say how old I was, so I said all but 2 years. As a citizen and a volunteer in Federal Way community that we all live in, I understand the concern for the crime wave that we have been experiencing. We need to trust that our police department and our city officials are doing everything to solve these crimes. I volunteer and I work in the community, and when I'm out on my lunch hour, running errands, volunteering, I see officers out and about doing a great job and making sure that safety is number one in the city of Federal Way. A few months ago, a member of my family personally had a safety issue that required the Federal Way police to get involved, and it was investigated and handled appropriately. It is important at times like this to value the hours of work and the time that our city council, our police department, and any other officials they continue to give the city of Federal Way, and I hope that all of you find as much value in our city that we all live in as I do. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, James Barrier, then Harry Larson, then Doug, look like Oatby, and then Kira Brooks. So James Barrier, and then Harry Larson. James?
Thank you. First, let me say, Mr. Gutierrez, you held the door for my wife and I coming into the building tonight. And that's a testament of the kind of person you are and the kind of person your son is, that you did that 2 days after you lost your son. And that loss is not just to you, it's to us as well as a community. So thank you, and our condolences, thank you. And thank you to the City Council for having this meeting tonight. There are no easy answers to crime. There are many reasons why it happens, and so there's no one solution. But I will say that the strategies and tactics that are required go beyond just the police force. They require the city attorney. They require many other people, including the city council, to pitch in and make a concerted and coordinated effort to make a difference. Chief Huang mentioned that the crime rates in Federal Way are similar to other cities this size. That's true in some instances, it's not true in others. The question I would ask is that good enough for us? When we look at the things that happen, what are we doing if we catch a teenager with a gun? How's that child handled? What do we do when things happen that can lead to other more serious crimes? How are we handling those as a city and as a county? From what I've heard, and I'm going to say from what I've heard because I don't know if it's true or not, but the police budget was reduced by around $3 million this past year. It's not correct. What's the police budget?
Over the past 3 years, we've increased police spending by $3.6 million.
Increased by 3.6, okay. Okay. My question would be, how is that spending determined and how is it allocated? How much of that is patrol versus civilian and so forth? And what can we do to make that better? Thank you for your time.
Thank you, James. And James, when we get done with a citizen comment, we'll address some of those financials. I'll actually have our finance person address some of that, okay? Thank you. All right, Harry Larson, sir.
I'm not accustomed to public speaking, so initially I'd written my comment on the back of the thing. But I would like to mention one item. Panhandling in this city, while it's protected free speech, I think is a disgrace. And I'm willing, as a retired person, to, I would like to partner with someone, but I wouldn't mind going out there on a street corner with a sign saying, "Don't support panhandlers." I think that's protected free speech. If the lawyer says that's protected free speech, then why can't we do that?
You know, Harry, there's a council member up here who's actually there's another jurisdiction where that occurs, and there's been that suggestion that we put some of those signs up, but we haven't gone to that degree yet. Go ahead, Harry.
But I would be willing to do that. A few hours a day or a few hours a week is not a problem for me.
That's right.
And another thing. I know someone mentioned, and I think it's because of a fear of guns, but I'm 70 years old. I have a concealed carry permit. I'm not packing tonight, but I keep a gun at home, and it is loaded. There are no little kids in the house, no little kids expected. But I would encourage people, if they are service, if they've been in the service like I have in the Marine Corps, I'm perfectly capable of handling a weapon safely, and if I am packing in public and I see something going on, I'm going to first run because I don't want to get shot. But if your life is on the line or my life is on the line, I will defend you. And I just hope that there are others out there with the same attitude. I don't think there are too many guns in this city. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Harry. Doug Oatby, I hopefully I've got that right. Is it? All right, come on up, Doug. And then we've got Kira Brooks, and then Lisa Ludwig. What's that? Oh, I'm sorry. Thank you. All right, thank you. All right.
Yeah, I belong in this safe city for 47 years, and it continuously gets worse and worse. I had a guy over by the north side of the Federal Way High darn near run me over tonight because he couldn't stop for a stop sign. And I'm sick and tired of between traffic problems that you guys are never there. I think it's time you guys grab the bull by the horns, hire some people, and start doing something about this instead of letting it go right over your head all the time. And I've talked to you before, and I've talked to Andy, and I don't see Andy in here.
Andy's over there, Doug. You can talk to him when you're all done. You can go over there. Go ahead, sir.
Anyhow, between all that and the drugs in my neighborhood that I've been talking to you, sir, for 3 years, and nothing has been done, I want to sell my house. Nobody's going to buy my house because I've got druggies on the corner. I've got people that come out of jail. And they're not doing what you and I do for a living because they got all kinds of brand new cars, expensive cars. Where are they getting their money? Certainly not from working. So I think you guys better grab the bull by the horns and start doing something about this stuff.
Thank you, Doug. Thank you. And you try to. Kira Brooks. And then Lisa Ludwig.
I'm just commenting on what the gentleman prior said regarding panhandlers. Panhandlers beg because people give them something. Don't give them money, don't give them food, don't give them clothes, don't give them anything. There's multi-service center over here that will help all of them. And that's where the problem comes. And you see people giving food. Even my mother gives food. I said, don't do that. You hear on 2020 how much they actually make and they put money in the bank, probably more than a lot of us have. And so please don't do that. And then my other question is, Section 8, what percentage do you guys believe crime is going to increase with that on 320th? With each Section 8, there's a percentage of increase in crime. And yes. I've lived here 20 years, too, and it's gotten awful, where, as the one lady, I want to move. And it saddens me greatly.
I'm sorry to hear that. Kira, when we get done with that, we're going to address, I'll have the chief address, what we're projecting, and it's difficult to project those, but we're going to address that when the citizen comment are up.
There is a force, I know that.
Yeah. Thanks, Kira. All right, Lisa Ludwig. And then, Lisa, before you get started, we've got a little bit of delay with the folks in the other room. I'm going to read the names of the people in other rooms to get them up here so we don't lose time. And I've got... Elizabeth Carey, Saadia Sanders, Darlene Coleman, Dion Shell. So let me do it again real quick. Elizabeth Carey, Saadia Sanders, Darlene Coleman, Dion Shell. So if you could make your way into the room, that'd be great. And we may need to make room for them. All right, Lisa, go ahead.
I used to live here for 18 years, and I had to move because there was a bully bullying me around in Federal Way, and I had to move. Her name was Jenny Malcolm, and I had to move because of her, and she's been stalking me, harassing me, and I had to move from Federal Way, and I'm in Action Club, and I wish this crime rate would drop.
All right. Thank you, Lisa. Thank you. Elizabeth Carey. Do we have Elizabeth up here yet? Come on up, Elizabeth. And then Saadia Sanders.
Chief Wong gave a presentation that was very general in the city's response to this particular crime or set of crimes, how the city is responding and reallocating resources. I, as somebody who lives two blocks from where one of the shootings was, I'm interested in the specifics, not just the generalities. What is the theory or the theories behind these crimes? What evidence that can be disclosed publicly at this time is there to back up those theories? And is the city, the police, any place near identifying suspects behind these crimes? And those would be my questions. and I hope they get answered.
Elizabeth, let me say a couple of things generally. I was in communication with the King County Prosecutor's Office earlier today, and when a homicide occurs anywhere in King County, they dispatch what they refer to as an MDOP deputy. It's essentially a homicide deputy that works in conjunction with each police department. They've got the very top part of that office, from the elected King County prosecutor to the chief criminal deputy to the head of the homicide unit. They've dispatched like multiple different MDOP deputies on this. What they're doing is they're looking at the evidence of each one of these. There's all kinds of evidence that the detectives have at this point, but you can imagine that the most important thing right now is to capture these people. And so what we've got to do, and I've talked to the chief, there is evidence that obviously we have evidence, but it's very important that we retain the integrity of the investigations so then we can hold these individuals accountable, and if there are connections between them, that we can make them. So I could tell you that in regard to the specific investigations, we've got to be very careful, because we want to make sure that those, when we catch these individuals, we want to make sure those prosecutions stand, and we want to make sure that no statement can be used in a courtroom and in a court proceeding later that undermines those prosecutions. But one of the things I want to say, Elizabeth, is, Chief, can you talk just real briefly about when we, I think she was asking for details about what are the specific details in regard to the change in practice in regard to the patrols and the emphasis in that part of town.
We have taken all of our specialty assignments, officers assigned to the Special Operations Unit, Special Investigations Unit, the uniform side. We have allocated overlap shift. We have canceled training for June to increase our staffing significantly on the field. And we've allocated additional personnel to the investigative section. As I stated earlier, there is nothing more important for the Federal Way Police Department to solve this crime. This is an active investigation with a lot of moving parts, and it was very deliberate on my part not to share anything about the investigation. We're at the infancy stages of this investigation, and I hope people respect that. We want to solve this crime more than anybody else. So just know that we have people working very hard, but it would not be appropriate to discuss the investigation.
But Elizabeth, there's one other piece is, we're not just relying on just our police force. We're reaching out to the FBI and every available federal and state resource, and we're talking to our local police partners as well.
Okay. Thank you. One other thing that I'd like to say that's somewhat unrelated, and it is making me sad as I sit here and listen to people's comments, how many people are, perhaps not consciously, but are disparaging people simply because they are poor. Just because people, just because people are in a financial position that they have to take public assistance or move into Section 8 housing, which has a lengthy list, does not make them murderers or criminals. Sure, some of them might be, but so are some of the general population.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Okay, Saadia Sanders. Saadia? And then after that, we've got then Darlene Coleman. Saadia, go ahead.
All right, so just to let you guys know, I don't speak in public as well, but I do want to give my condolences to all the families that have lost somebody, not just, you know, one family, because everybody here is important. There is going to be more losses, and I just think it's important, if you're going to say that it's young people that are doing the shootings, then parents need to take charge, not just the children. The schools need to take charge. I see the police out, and you guys are doing a wonderful job, but it happens all in the home. It starts all in the home at a young age. So if we're not going to have parents that are going to be able to educate the children on what's going on, I mean, I'm sure they see it, but I see a lot of children trying to fit in, and it's not about fitting in. You guys need to, you know, be safe. There's people's lives at stake, and I don't think it's not a game, you know. And then, sorry if I, you know, just stop me if I go too long. But touching on the Section 8 thing, and I do definitely agree with the last person who spoke before me. It's not just a Section 8 thing. My family's on Section 8. I'm 17. I work two jobs. I go to Highline, and I'm doing what I need to do.
Yeah.
So I just don't think if we're gonna sit here and we're gonna try to bring the community together, I don't think it's a place to bring your discriminations or your prejudices, because we're trying to stand together. We're not trying to separate people, but we're standing together as a community and as a people and individuals. We're not trying to separate, because that's only gonna cause more violence if you guys are gonna act like that. That's not the type of vibe that we need to have when trying to build a community up. So I just gotta say that we will make it great again. Spread Away will be safe again, but we can't do it if everybody else isn't gonna be individuals. We have to stand together and make this happen.
Well said, Sadia. Darlene Coleman, and then Dion Shell.
Good afternoon, or good evening. I'd like to give my condolences to the families. I would like to stand with that young lady and say that in this meeting, we have to be ever so mindful that we are not further separating ourselves. We're not going to do anything separated. Section 8 housing, I've been a homeowner in Federal Way for 14 years. I've raised two of my boys here. I have 8 children. And Federal Way is a great community. It's going to stay a great community. Yay. As long as we unite. We have some issues going on right now, but the first thing we do is separate. Once we start separating, we will separate ourselves, period. We have to unite together around our youth, because if that's what we're thinking that's causing this or having this problem, that just like that young lady said, something is starting in the home. We have educators in here. We have police in here. We got community organizations in here. We need to identify what's going on and come together as a community, a family of community. It takes more than one family to raise a child, whether we've gotten away from that or not. We need to stand together. And if we don't stand together, we will see people. We can bring commerce in here all day, but when you have guns in your homes and you have the right to have a gun in your home, I have the right to have mine in my home. But if somebody breaks in my home and now they have my gun, now it's an uncontrollable situation. All I'm saying is that if we separate, if we talk about Section 8, people on Section 8, they're the ones bringing the crime in. No, I own a home, and I have someone on Section 8 in my home, and they have a strict policy that they have with Section 8 people. They're not scum. So if we get to thinking about people who are lower income and all that, they're bringing the crime. No, it's not them. Crime comes in, it rolls through, and it rolls out. As long as we stand together as a community, this too shall pass.
Okay. Dion Shell, Alicia Albritton, Libby Ray. So Dion Shell, Alicia Albritton, Libby Ray, and then Kyle Wall. Hi, Dion.
How you doing, sir? I'm actually used to speaking in public. However, I'm a bit sad tonight for a few reasons. Number one, I want to send my condolences out to the family that's here and all the families who've experienced any kind of violence throughout Federal Way. I'm a new resident. I moved my family here from Issaquah. I'm from the east side. I came here. I forced my wife to come here. My wife is over here. It was my passion within the work that I do. I work with youth. I work within the district. I have 5 children here. I'm a volunteer at Rainier View Elementary School, at Sequoia Middle School, and Ty Beamer High School. I'm an active parent, and I'm a member of the younger generation, so I appreciate all of you here for all of your views, opinions, and the concern that you have for the city, because I want to make this city mine too. But I need y'all to understand, these new apartment complexes coming in are not the reason why the crime is changing. It's not the reason why the community is changing. I'll be completely honest, coming here, I heard every bad thing not to come to Federal Way. I had every professional colleague tell me that's the wrong place to go, but that's not my attitude. I run to the problems. I know I can make an impact here. I know I can make an impact in the schools. My kids go to these schools. I can easily be assumed to be one of the people contributing to the problems here. So I need y'all to be a little bit more welcoming to these new communities, because at the end of the day, I live in one of those new communities. I'm not on Section 8, never have been. None of my family is, none of my friends are. There are a lot of good people that live there that have nothing to do with what's going on with this. So I need y'all to be a little bit more encouraging to the new residents coming here. To the new residents coming here, be a little bit more encouraging. I understand. You see your community changing in a bad direction, and you're concerned about it. Please be concerned. Continue to be concerned.
Well, you guys got all wrong ideas.
But don't blame it all on one apartment complex. Don't blame it all on these apartment complexes. And don't assume everybody's on Section 8. I came here to be a homeowner. I'm in transition right now. I got 5 kids. I'm working my tail off to be a homeowner. Don't label me as Section 8, especially not by where I live. If you really care about your community, take time to dig into it. Bring everybody together. Don't just step out and you be over here and they be over there and say it's guns here and it's the apartments here and it's the police here. We all gotta take a role in this. If you're not taking a role, you need to accept the challenge right now. If we lost 3 people this week, if you ain't doing nothing tomorrow, then you contributing to that. So I challenge everybody in here. If you really care about this community, do something today. Don't just sit here and talk about it. Don't come here with your comments. Don't assume that everybody that you don't understand is part of the problem. If you're not doing something, you're part of the problem.
Thanks, Dion. All right, Alicia Albritton. And then Libby Ray and Kyle Wall.
All right, first off, I do have disabilities, so if anything comes off wrong, I apologize, but I want to say I'm sorry to the families who have lost people. Now, for me, this is kind of difficult because I'm a Section 8 person myself, and I have disabilities, so it's hard for me. I've actually sat and kept saying I didn't want to deal with Section 8 because I cannot get into any apartments because of the way Section 8 is. I'm barely holding on to a job right now with the fact that I have disabilities. I'm constantly having to take off because of health issues. I'm still trying to fight health issues now. I'm like literally tooth and nail about to lose another job that I've had for 4 years. I've got nieces and nephews who live in an apartment complex. I have walked outside and I'm constantly hearing how negative and provocative kids are talking. I've seen kids just laying in the middle of the street where cars are parked, and that's not good. So I'm trying to find a way to give back to the community. I'm also trying to find a way to help my community. I actually was living in an apartment called the Cambridge Park Apartments, and I seen 2 kids literally just about get hit by a car because they were playing a game with, oh, let's run this way, let's start this way, let's start this way, let's start that way. And the 2 kids just about got hit, and almost another car almost hit the other car, and I actually had to walk into my leasing office and say, you guys need to do something because kids are about to get hit because they're daring the cars to hit them. And it's not safe. But it's also not safe if nobody else is helping parents with the kids. If parents are at work and they can't find sitters or can't find people, I have actually gotten an associate's degree. I'm actually now trying to work on my bachelor's degree. But with the fact that I have disabilities, it makes everything hard for me. And every apartment that I've gone into, the rent keeps getting raised higher and higher and higher. And because of disabilities that I have, there's certain things I can't do. There's certain things I'm trying to force myself to do. And at the end of the day, it's like I'm tooth and nail. If I can't come up with money, if I end up losing this job, I can't do it because Social Security, with people that are on disabilities, Social Security is telling us you're not allowed to get no more than this amount. And if it comes from family members, then I end up having to turn around and back pay the state. So you can't always say it's Section 8 people that are doing things wrong. But then you also have to kind of look at, is there any way that older kids can be a positive role model for the younger generation? That's what I'm trying to do. And if you guys need my help, I live in the Pavilion Apartments. Would love to help out with kids. I'm great with kids.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks, Alicia. Libby Ray, and then Kyle Wall, and then Lou Jocelyn Lester.
Okay, I moved here in 1968, and I think Fedway has some of the best Mount Rainier views and Puget Sound views, and we're all here because we care. So that's the first thing. I'm currently a substitute teacher, elementary school and one middle school. And the city hall sign that announced this meeting was tagged. And so some of us were wondering if gang activity is a focus. And can there be a building moratorium on apartments just in general? And I bring that up because the schools are already crowded, and there is not a new school on the docket to be built anytime soon from what we know. And I bring that up because we have part-time counselors at elementary schools. So let's hope you have a problem on Tuesday because she's not going to be there on Thursday. And we all wonder how do the kids fall through the system? Starting at a young level, these kids that have lackadaisical parents, they need extra help. We have to have that in the school because it may be the only place they can get it. And that goes for the high school, but we got to start at a young age. My son went to kindergarten with one of the boys that was in the car in the Taco Bell parking lot, one of the possible shooters. He went to school with them. We all cared about him. We can only do so much, but we need the counselors, all of that support. And just a note, the 19-year-old that was shot at the Cove Apartments on First Avenue, he grew up in a home in a cul-de-sac. He wasn't an apartment kid. So the drugs, the gang activity, it goes across the board to different individuals. What I think a lot of us parents would like to see is the police department actively in the schools, kind of along the lines of Scared Straight. If you decide to start doing drugs, want to join a gang, want to start selling the drugs, you can end up dead. You can end up having to initiate something that's, I think it kind of needs to be a focus. You choose this. These are some of the consequences of what can happen. And you could end up losing your life on both ends. And no, I'm not done yet. But I think just the emphasis with the police department in the schools more, somehow not having these schools so crowded where the teachers can only help the kids so much. We need the counselors, we need psychologists, we need that type of stuff. It starts at a young age, and they go through the system, and we can get to some of these kids before they end up in a parking lot. And this is way too close to home. I serve on the Little League board with the cousin of Adam. And so it's way too close to home.
Thank you, Libby.
Thank you.
Libby, in follow-up to at least two of your issues in regard to gang activity and building moratorium, we'll address that when we're done with the questions, okay? All right, Kyle Wall. And then Lou Jocelyn Lester. And then Skylar Nichols, or Skyman. And then Greg Vickers.
Hello, my name is Kyle Wall. I am 28 years old. Grew up in Federal Way, moved away for about 4 years for college, and my wife and I settled back here. Fighting back emotions, this city means a lot to me. And I want to make a challenge to the people of this city. I hear so many people from Federal Way, but unfortunately, I don't hear of enough people who stay here. They often leave. And it's tempting. I know when things are tough, it's tempting to run. And I want to encourage people like Dion said. Dion, you hit it on the head, man. I didn't even need to come up here after you said that. I encourage you to stay and to fight and don't leave. Don't think that, you know, we're the armpit or anything like that, or because new apartments are coming in that you need to get out of here. It's crossed my mind, and it's wrong thinking, and I'm the first to own that. And so be a part of the change. Be proud to live here. You know, when I lived on the east side, it's like you go to a party and people make fun of it down here, and it's like beating up your little kid brother. Only I can do that. You can't talk about that. And so I just want to encourage you, be part of the change here. Don't think that it's okay to run. Dig your heels in. And I think that the best way to honor, especially the gentleman who is running, I don't recall his name, but what if that was a catapult to change the city in honor of him and his life? And so please fight, dig your heels in, don't leave the city. Thank you.
Thank you, Kyle. Lou Jocelyn Lester, and then Skylar Nichols.
Hi, excuse me. Hi there to all of you who know me. I've been a resident of Federal Way since I was a child. No, not really. For 46 years now, and I've lived in the same house for 46 years, and have been on committees and commissions and boards to work with our city people to promote awareness of how good our city can be. My condolences again to the Gutierrez family, and I am also a U.S. Navy veteran, Vietnam era veteran. But what I would like to be able to promote also is more cooperation with our police department and probably more funding for the police. I have squatters that live next door to me now, and at first they were druggies. And the police came and arrested one and tried to get another one, and they surrounded the house. And I came out and I said, can I move my car? And he says, get in the house. Okay. So, and now I have a chop shop next door, and they have cars there all night and honking and stereos. The police aren't enough to take care of every corner of Federal Way. We have grown since we first moved here. And I just want us to be able to support each other, stay, volunteer, get involved in your community. And there aren't just bad people out there. There are a few people that probably never lived here before and came, with a few exceptions. So let us support our council people and our police and all the people that are involved in trying to help this community retain its good reputation and become even better. Thank you all tonight.
Thank you, Lou. Skylar Nichols, Skyman, and then Greg Vickers.
Greetings and salutations, citizens of Federal Way. I'm Federal Way's real-life superhero, Skyman. I do a lot of driving around patrols now because I have my driver's license back. Yay, took me a while. I have a car. Yay, took me a while too. I'm sure a lot of you have seen me walking down the streets waiting for the bus, but I haven't done that in the past year. Yay, anyway. My condolences to the Gutierrez family. I met Ben a while back, and he was a great guy. He inspired me to do a lot in my community. And it was just Tuesday night. I was watching the news and had my window open, and pop, 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 pop. It was four blocks down from me. Scary. It's scary when it hits home. We don't need to have it be scary. We need to stand up. All this bemoaning Section 8, poverty people, let's not do that. That's, like a lot of people said, that's separating. That's creating them versus us, not we. Let's be we. We stand up for our community. We stand up for our city. Doesn't matter income, socioeconomic status, gender, race, creed, color, none of that matters. We're all people of Federal Way. We all love our city, and we're all here for one reason, and that's to have our voices be heard. That's to have the elected officials know that we care and know that we want something to happen. What that something is, that's not up to us. That's up to our elected officials to decide on. I love the Federal Way Police Department. They're great guys. They know me. We get along famously. They're not the problem. I've heard statistics about Everett having 200 cops and Federal Way only having 130. Well, Federal Way is not that big yet, but we are growing. you see all these high-rise apartment complexes going up. That's because the prices in the city of Seattle are skyrocketing. Where else are people going to move to? North King County? That's even more expensive. So we're going to experience a flood of people into South King County. Let's welcome them. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Scott Mann. Greg Vickers, and then Jan Zimmer.
Hello, my name is Greg Vickers. I've been a resident here for 38 years. One of the most important things that I have heard tonight is two things. Number one is not be divided. I'm calling our city, not just the city council, the police department, but the community to gather in a task force to take back our city. I think it's pure time that we, in this large community, I remember when it was small, but to think about what we can do individually. I asked the city to bring together a World Cafe specifically around this to start looking at actionable items that we can do to take back our city. The crime in our community has risen, at least it looks that way. Statistically, as we've seen tonight, it looks flat. But when it impacts you, it is massive. So my point to you tonight is, it's not how many police that we have in our community. It's not whether we build the pack or not. It's really about we as a community taking back our community and helping the city do that. Thank you.
And Greg, there are members of the council that have been calling for that, as well as members of the community. And the first planning meeting, it is something that we're going to be starting, the first planning for that meeting for that is this coming Monday. And we will be putting that task force together to address these issues. We're going to be talking about this likely as a council here in just a few moments. But that is something that we're going to be calling on, that's been called on by the council and also by the community. So we're acting on that. Thank you. All right, Jan Zimmer. Let's just pass Jan for a second. It could take a minute for Jan to get in the room. Carol Fraley. And then Valerie Rhodes.
I'd like to also offer my condolences. I'd like to thank the council for being here and doing this for us. And I'd like to thank the police department. They do need our support, but they also need our legislatures. They need Linda Coleman behind us. They need every one of the state legislatures, and they need judicial support. Our laws are not strong enough to make the people who have committed this murder responsible. There's a very large sign, two very large signs on 356. I drive by it every day. I live on 356. I drive by it going to Lowe's because I like to garden. And that gentleman was broken into, I was told, by three children. And you cannot call them children when they do property damage. It doesn't matter what age you are, you have to be held responsible. So if you take a 17-year-old boy and call him a child, you are wrong. You have to start making them responsible. You have to make the drug addicts responsible. If they live in Section 8 housing, get them out of Section 8 housing. If they live on the streets, get them off of the streets. Let's start using our judicial power and our legislative power to write stronger laws. Thank you.
Thank you, Carol. You know, I have forgotten one of our council members, Councilmember Lydia Acefa Dawson, is out of state. She is unable to be here for this. This was obviously not pre-scheduled. We scheduled this within 48 hours. So her absence tonight is excused. Valerie Rhodes.
Good evening. My condolences to the families of the victims, not only of the Gutierrez family, but really all of the victims here in Federal Way, because there's more than just gun violence going on, sadly, in our community. I've lived in this community since 1974, born and raised, graduated all the elementary schools, graduated Federal Way High School, and what I've seen this community do is always be reactive instead of proactive. Back in the early 80s, we had an influx of apartment complexes that sat vacant because there was no Section 8 housing to come and live in them. And then all of a sudden, the other communities was the gossips that were, you know, sending their people to here to Federal Way, and we were reactive to that situation. We didn't build more schools fast enough. Thus, now we still have another school problem. We have a homeless problem, thus the panhandling, thus the people living in the bushes, thus the people breaking into homes to steal anything they can to go to the local pawn shops to pay for whatever they need to survive one more day. It seems to me that Federal Way needs to be much more proactive in their development, whether it's bringing more police officers on board. I'm sorry, but I think 130 police officers for 90-plus thousand people is not enough. I'm a homeowner in this community. I'm a business owner in this community. And when I get called the police because I have people dealing drugs in my parking lot, not to downplay murders because it has to start someplace, and sadly, murders have now brought us all together as a community. But when I call and say they are dealing drugs in my parking lot, and the 911 operator says, can you take a picture of them? Right. My response is, are you flipping kidding me? I live here. They know I'm here on a daily basis. Why would I take their pictures and then risk my life? That's why I'm calling the police to come help, serve, and protect me and my community, my property. So it seems to me that we need to be much more proactive in solving a lot of issues, not to mention our violence, our gangs, our schools. So I ask you, Mayor, what are we doing to address a lot of these problems? Because there is a new performing arts center going in, sadly right next to a transit station that has issues. Why are we not building another school? I mean, my children go to Nautilus Elementary School, and the PTSA is looking at figuring out a way to bring portables in. We're a PTSA bringing portables in because our school district doesn't have enough money. I'm sorry, that's wrong. That's why we all pay taxes, isn't it? I don't know about you, but I pay a lot of taxes. I want it to help our community, not just be another bill I pay, and I'm resentful for it. So would love to hear how you're going to help us with a lot of these issues.
Well, thank you, Valerie, very much for your comments. I do want to say that this council has consistently raised the number of officers. Just a few years ago, we were at about 122 officers on hand, then we moved it to 126, and then we fully budgeted up to 131. So that those numbers have gone up by about 9 officers over the years. So Jan Zimmer.
One more thing. Just to clarify that, do you really think that's enough officers? When I call, when I'm gone and have an alarm system go off and it takes 44 minutes, that could have been a murder in my house.
There are standards, Valerie. There are standards, and what we'll do is when the comment is over, I'll turn it over. There are national standards on how many officers per 1,000 people, and we'll talk about that.
Okay,
thank you very much. Is Jan Zimmer, did Jan Zimmer make it back? Okay, we'll just go ahead and, sorry, Jan, we missed you. Shamian Heiliger? Shamian Heiliger? Now, this comes from another room, so it may take a moment. Julianne Frink and Kevin Butler. Are any of those individuals in the room? Kevin Butler?
Thank you. First of all, my condolences to the family as well. I wasn't going to speak, but Dion, you struck a nerve with me, and I had to follow up. One of the founding principles of this great nation was we the people. We the people are the ones that are going to solve this problem, okay? We have, as has been mentioned before, 90,000 people. We have 130 police officers. They're vastly outnumbered. Just do the math, okay? But we the people can make a difference. And I'd like to share something that happened in our neighborhood, and it worked. We had some illegal activity going on. We the people, we got to know our neighbors. Do you know the person that lives next door to you? Do you know the person that lives across the street from you? Do you have their cell phone number? Do you know what their schedule is? Do you understand their comings and goings? Do you know when something happens that's not ordinary? And next question, are you willing to call them? Are you willing to ask if they're okay? We banded together as a neighborhood. We kept the pressure on. We called the Federal Way Police Department. They were very cooperative. We called the non-emergency number. Let them know when we saw the activity going on. And we kept the pressure on till the activity stopped. So we the people can make a difference. Don't think you can't. It's very simple. Get to know your neighbors. Get to know who they are. Get to know when they come. Get to know when they go. And be willing to make a phone call. Check on your neighbor. Make sure they're okay. And if you see something happening, call the tips line. Call the non-emergency line. It does work. Thank you.
Sir, would you tell us your name one more time?
Kevin Butler.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Thank you. All right, do we have Shamian? Heiliger. Hi.
My name is Shamim. It's a community issue. It's not a Section 8 issue. It's not the rich people or the poor people issue. We need to come together. I've got four boys at home that I'm raising from ages 6 to 17. My husband and I are doing our part. With that many boys in the house, it's boot camp in our house. We're teaching them to do the right things. We need to come together as a community. Jim, I need to know what you guys are doing, what the community is doing, so I don't get that phone call. I don't want that phone call. None of these people want that phone call. I think that I don't know what the answers are, but I think coming together like this and getting ideas, I don't know if we have to have a gun exchange program. I don't know if that's going to work. And not for money. Maybe they need, you know, turn in your guns to have some kind of work training to go to school. I don't know what it's going to take, you know. But I think that this is a good start, but I think the people want answers.
Shamim, that's excellent. In fact, that's why several members of the council have been calling for this task force, and that's exactly the kind of idea that we're going to get.
Yeah.
So
I think that there's people in the community doing their part. We just need that backup, you know, from you guys to really push hard to get these people off the streets or mental health, maybe partnering up with, you know, Virginia Mason or St. Francis or Group Health to get some mental help for the people that really need it.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks.
All right, thanks, Shamim. All right. Julianne Frink.
Yeah.
Hi, Julianne.
I think I saw you in 4th of July. I said hi to you. What I hate the most is that people slandering Section 8, because there's a lot of people that I live on Section 8 that lived on it for years. And those are people with low income people that can't afford apartments that are at high prices. And I've lived where I live for 16 years. And now it's 1,015, and the new apartments that are coming in today, it has nothing to do with them, nothing. They're just brand new apartments that just came in. They're one's a year old, the other one's brand new. The one on 320th is just coming brand new. What we need to focus on is the crime at hand, which is right now, not Section 8, not any agency that, you know, because I know that Section 8 can be bad. You know, Section 8 could be like, you know, people slandering, you know, wrecking apartments and stuff like that. And there's a lot of people that don't take Section 8 because of it. And I know it. Because I, you know, I'm pretty good at knowing. I'm a smart lady, even though I have a learning disability. But I know for my fact that Section 8 is not a bad thing. It was never was. This is the problem, is that the shootings, you know, because, you know, you don't shoot someone just walking down the road and, you know, walking their dog and, you know, what's the purpose of that? It's really not.
It's senseless.
It's senseless. So we need to focus on that. We need to focus on anything else, just the crime. I'm scared for myself. I have a 21 boy at home at my mom's, and my mom told him that he couldn't go out at night at all, and I don't go out at night either. My mom told me the same thing. So it's scary. It's scary for me. You know, I'm 47, you know, and I go around a lot. I go downtown, you know, everywhere. So, but thank you for listening.
Thanks, Julian.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Did we ever find Jan Zimmer? You guys, I am out of sheets. Oh, I've got a couple more here. Okay. And even when we get out of sheets, if you want to say something, we're going to make sure you get to. All right, great. Okay. We're refilled. All right. So I'll call them out. You guys get a line. Okay. Nick Van Adder, Jody Anderson, Donald Berovic, and Betty Taylor. Nick, you're up. Thank you.
All right, thank you. I consider myself part of the Federal Way community, even though I don't live here. My father did his student teaching at Federal Way High School in the late 70s, so I had a deep tie there. I also have been the manager of a local retailer for 10 plus years. In those 10 years, I have seen a drastic decline in the population of Federal Way as far as how it's dealing with a lot of the issues that it comes across. Everybody talks about, you know, a safe city. Everybody wants to be part of the safe city. The problem is we're moving almost in opposite direction, becoming a safe city for those that are committing those crimes. Most of the property crimes that are committed, most of the theft from retail, most of the things that people are taking to support habits that are part of the bigger problem aren't prosecuted. They're not being prosecuted because they're not worth the time and money of the city. Well, the problem is those small thefts of $20 to $30 are, number one, an issue to the retailer, to the private citizen, to whoever it's being stolen from, and that's just saying, it's okay, because we're not gonna prosecute it. We'll give you a fine. If you don't show up or pay your fine, we're gonna maybe do a warrant, but we're never gonna follow up on it. We have a bigger problem in this community, not just with the large scale problems that we have. Unfortunately, we had a very large problem that has arisen recently, but it's all stemming from the fact that we are allowing a lot of the smaller things to kind of be swept under the rug and not be taken care of. We want a safe city, make it a safe city for those that want a safe city, not a safe city for those that are committing crimes. Thank you.
Thank you, Nick. Jody Anderson.
Good evening. There's a lot more people here tonight than the last time I spoke. I'm a little nervous. Thank you, Mayor Farrell, and the rest of the City Council for convening this emergency meeting in light of the recent violent crimes that we have suffered in our community. Let me start off by saying to the friends and family of Wesley Jennings, to the friends and family of Jeff McLaren, to the friends and family of Alex Kelly, to the friends and family of Frank Cowens Jr., and finally, to the friends and family of Adam Gutierrez, we grieve with all of you. I would like to turn my comments now to Chief Wang. I want to say thank you to you and the entire Federal Way Police Department for all that you do on a daily basis, night and day, putting your lives on the line to try and keep our community safe, oftentimes with resources that aren't adequate. We appreciate all you do. Yeah. To Mayor Farrell and council members, this uptick in deadly violence cannot continue. We need to be sure that our police force has all the necessary resources they need to protect our city. I don't believe they do. I am not interested, with all due respect, in fancy PowerPoint presentations with graphs and statistics that tell me crime is down and that our police department is adequately staffed. Clearly it isn't, and sadly, the proof is in the five lives lost to deadly violence in just 3 months. We need to put officers on the street now. If that means shifting funding from other non-essential projects to hire more officers, then so be it. Finally, to my neighbors, we're all neighbors. I don't care if you live on the South End, the North End, or anywhere in between. For several months now, there has been a concerted effort by concerned citizens to create a coalition of vested stakeholders, including the City Council, our police department, our school district, churches, and other social service agencies to have ongoing dialogue about the safety of our community. I am very pleased to hear tonight that that's going to happen, and I thank you. There's an overflow of people tonight in City Hall who clearly want to be involved. Put us to work. Let us help make this community safe for all of us. Thank you.
Thank you, Jody. Thank you, Jody. Well said. Donald Berevic, and then Betty Taylor, and then Jenny. Sir?
Good evening. This is a very extemporaneous speech.
because I got lost coming over here. I apologize for that. Dina, it's nice to see you. Mr. Mayor, the tragedy of a lost life is difficult. I've lost a child, and there's nothing more difficult. The problem with this municipality is I think we've just outgrown what we would like to have. The things I see and I observe on television sometimes are quite shocking. And I'm wondering what my grandchildren are going to observe and see because of the, I guess it's the greed of those that are in power that provide us with that thing called television. I had an early life, I was in the motion picture theater business, and it was an unusual business at that time. But we survived, and I still have a theater. And I would like to share with you that I have worked closely with the Puyallup Indian tribe. And Russ Ladley, who's one of the biologists that's with the tribal council, said this is the worst return he has ever seen. And he's been with the Indian tribe as a biologist for 35 years. That is something to be concerned with. It's one of our resources, and I would like to see it propagated. Thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight. I'm a little older and no wiser, the little piece of property that I have in Federal Way is a jewel. It's a beautiful jewel, and I would like to think that it will be around. Dina, I know you've been there, and yep, my time's up. Anyhow, thank you, and have a pleasant evening.
Thank you, Don. Betty Taylor, and then Jenny Hills. And then we're out of pink sheets again. So bring them up. Come on, bring them up this way, please. Hi, Betty.
When I think of the phrase, I pledge allegiance to the flag in the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God. And I think about that phrase, one nation under God. You know, Better Way is one nation under God. And I believe that God is our only answer. You know, and I know I was thinking about the churches that are in Better Way. There are 96 churches in the city of Better Way. And I believe all the churches should come together. I think the community should come together as a whole. I think the organizations should come together as a whole. I think the apartment complexes should come together as a whole. I'm working on a project in Seattle right now, and we're trying to work on a rally. And we're going to call it, it's basically called Prayer for Reno Valley. And basically, we're basically trying to get churches and communities and organizations and businesses together in one place so we can figure out how to combat this thing that we call crime. We're trying to bring people together. We're trying to bring organizations together. We're trying to come up with strategic plans and solutions. And we're trying to meet together, like on a regular basis. And I think that's the same thing that Federal Way needs to do, not just meet one time and just call it done. It has to be consistent, and it has to be persistent, and people have to be involved. Because if you're not involved, it's not going to work. Everybody in this room has to be involved. The people that are in this room now cannot die off. You have to stand together as one, because I know the city council will. So we have to stand with them and with each other to make all this happen. And I too grieve for the families that are here.
Thank you, Betty. Jenny Mills.
Hi, my name is Jennifer Marie Malcolm Hills, and I've lived in Federal Way since September 18th, 1987. I had come to you guys earlier this year with a complaint that there was a driver that was going 35 miles an hour in a 15 mile an hour zone. I live at Waterbury Apartment Complex, where there is significant drug and alcohol dealing 24 hours a day. People are playing their music after 10 o'clock. There are little kids, 3 to 12 years of age or more, sleeping in these apartment complexes. The parents don't know what to do. We are at a standstill. I'm tired of seeing Federal Way under. There was a student at our high school that was killed. Her name was Sarah Yarbrough. I don't think any of you remember her, but I did go to the high school, and I only knew her twice. We have got to do something. These kids don't need to have or be involved with guns at 3 years of age and up. They don't. You know, I'm tired of people speeding in and out of the apartment complex where I live, people on the back roads. There is no safety for the kids in the morning. These kids are up between, 5:30 to 7:30 for their buses. These buses come by. There's no safety traffic signals. There's nothing. We had a kid that went to Lake Dolph this year. He was almost hit. In a 15-mile-per-hour zone, he was going 35 miles with his Jeep. There's two witnesses in there. This is what we need to be dealing with. These kids are supposed to be our future. I have a 7-year-old. I won't even let him out of our apartment at night unless I'm with him, with his dad, nobody. These kids need the protection in these apartment complexes. It's awful. It really is. What are you, you know, we have a drug dealer that lives in one of the buildings. What's this going to be done about? He brings women in and out day and night. You know, this needs to be addressed. The apartment complexes need 24-hour security. They need to have people come, maybe live with us for a day and night. See how the people with disabilities in Federal Way live. There is, Section 8 has nothing to do with the domestic violence, nothing. So, you know, this needs to be addressed, and it needs to be addressed now before these kids get a hold of more guns.
Thank you, Jenny. Dee Barnes. Dee Barnes. And then Bobby Jennings and Heidi Gutierrez. Hi, Dee.
Hi. I've lived here for a long time. I'm sorry about your son and your husband and daughter and all, for everybody. I have actually seen a decline as well. I've been here since second grade, but I also work with the school districts, not here in Federal Way, but another one. But that's beside the point. I think that we need to, in the school, we need to start this in the schools, kindergarten, preschool, because I have kids on my bus, and this is not just a Federal Way issue. I'm telling you, it's more probably an America issue. These kids are not being raised with the my opinion, sorry if I'm offending somebody, but my opinion is these children need to be supported. And a lot of times, 9 times out of 10, they're home by themselves. Who is there to protect those children who are home by themselves? But I understand parents need to work and that kind of thing, but when you have a child that's in kindergarten and they're getting themselves off to school by themselves, even a first grade, second grade, who's there to help them? You know, and so we have all these issues, drugs. Heroin is a huge issue, guys. Heroin in middle school. Middle school, heroin, meth, huge. And we're all talking about, oh, Section 8, Section 8. You know what? It's in your backyard. It's not an apartment complex issue. It's a state issue. Look up, get your resources, look it up. It's bigger than you guys can even imagine, and we're not really doing anything for it, and it's frustrating as a mom, a sister, a brother. I watch these kids unattended. I'm like, where's that 4-year-old's mom? Where's that 4-year-old's sister? Where's that 4-year-old, 3-year-old? I mean, we got kids in a neighborhood running around. It's not just an apartment complex. It's everywhere. But we got to get a handle on. We need to support these middle schoolers. I was at the Taco Bell, okay? I was at a Taco Bell. I'm not scared of anything. I'm like, you know what? I'm going to hit things head on. I was at a Taco Bell the other day, just right over here where the Decatur student got killed in his car. And there was about 20 middle schoolers that came in that Taco Bell. And I'm going to tell you what, I was more scared of those freaking middle schoolers than anything. They come in F-bombing this, F-bombing that. I don't care about this. I'll go kick somebody's butt about that. Blah, blah, blah. Everybody. I'm like, really? Can't we just get along? You know, it starts that early, even kindergarten, first and second grade. There's no guidance in these kids' lives. Not everybody, but a lot of them don't have the guidance, and so they're looking for something, and so that's what they're doing. They're just looking for something. So, thanks, guys.
Thank you, Dee. Thank you for the work you do. Bobby Jennings. And then Heidi Gutierrez again.
I as well send my condolences to all of the families that were affected by this tragedy. I just want to say summer hasn't even hit yet, and this is happening right now. So our kids haven't even gotten out of school yet, and so we have to look at the greater concern that's coming. I can echo everything that everybody said. Section 8 doesn't breed criminals. Criminals breed criminals. Gang members breed gang members. Love breeds love. And I think that's what we have to continue. But there are various organizations in here. Dion, Lewis, those are community people that are willing to put their best foot forward to put a stop to some of this stuff. Our young kids are being pulled and lured by these adult criminals that are going out doing these things. And so we have to begin to put some reallocation of something to our young men and our young women out there who will get enticed by these dollar signs and these flashy cars and these guns that I'm seeing pictures constantly of 15-year-olds carrying 30 clips, mags, and guns walking around. 15-year-old kids. That has to stop. So I can echo everything that everybody's saying. All I'm saying is summer hasn't hit yet. And so we have to continue to figure out what are we going to do now to prepare for the summer to make sure that none of our other kids are impacted with the sense of senseless violence. So I'm for the kids. I love the kids. So I support all those that are working with the kids as well. So we gotta reallocate something somewhere.
Thank you, Bobby, and thank you for the work you do, Bobby. Bobby does a lot of work in our community with the kids. Thank you very much, Bobby. Heidi Gutierrez again. Heidi. And no timer, please.
I just wanted to say that I have nothing against people who live in Section 8 housing. I think Federal Way is overcrowded, and that is the problem. Not that they live in Section 8 housing, okay? That is not. It is that there are too many people in this small community, and they just keep building and keep bringing more people in. Multi-unit buildings. That is the problem, not Section 8. When somebody mentioned it, I yelled, and I just wanted everybody to know that it was not the Section 8. It was the multi-unit dwellings that is the problem, okay? I think when you have too many people in a small area, you're fighting, okay? 5 years ago, it took me 10 minutes to get across the city. It takes me 30 to 40 now, and it's not okay. I can't get off my street, and it makes people angry. I am cut off at least once to twice a day. I work for the Federal School District. I drive special needs kids every day. And I drive a big, ugly green van. And I tell you, I don't know why people don't see me, because I'm big. And it's ugly, okay? You have to see that person, my vehicle. But I'm cut off constantly. I have these special needs students in care. I have to be visual, okay? People are angry because they need to be places, and they're frustrated because the streets aren't wide enough. We don't have enough thoroughfares. There are so many issues, not just one, okay? But too many people in a small area is the problem. And that's all I just wanted people to not think that I was against Section 8 housing, okay? I have nothing against poor people. I know there's struggles, okay? Anyway, thank you for letting me talk again.
Thank you. Is there anybody else who'd like to talk? Come on up. yes, we're.
I just have a question.
Could you tell us your name, please?
Colleen Cornels.
Hi, Colleen.
I just have a question, and that is, I know you can't talk about the specifics of the investigation, but I think everybody in the room wants to know.
Yeah.
Are we any closer tonight than we were this morning at solving the crimes that have occurred?
Chief, did you hear the question that Colleen just asked? She wanted to know whether it was possible to say if we're any closer to solving the crime that occurred. The most recent, Mr. Gutierrez.
Mayor, again, I will say that we have some very talented individuals. We're working with various different organizations. Again, I don't think it'd be appropriate to discuss the investigation in any way. Just the citizens of Federal Way need to know that we are working steadfast towards solving these crimes.
And I think the key thing about this, trust me, as somebody who sat at council table for over 200 jury trials, you want to make sure you get this right. When we finally catch the people who did this, when we finally get them convicted, we want to make sure that conviction holds up, not a year from now, not 10 years from now, but life from now. And that's we want to make sure those convictions hold up. And it's very important that we get to that stage where we're actually in a courtroom and then beyond the courtroom. So could you please tell us your name, ma'am?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mayor Farrell, for having this meeting tonight. I appreciate everyone that came out. Thank you, Officer
Chief Wong.
Chief Wong, thank you for showing up tonight. I'm a resident. My name is Sheila Warren. I'm a resident of Federal Way, and I have been a resident of Federal Way since I moved here 8 years ago, and I moved here from Chicago, Illinois. And you think you have a problem in Federal Way? Try living in Chicago, Illinois. And you know, I moved out just in time because my kids were going into their teenage years. And you know what? It scared me, but I it was time for change. So I did move. I did make the change, and I moved here. But my son got worse here because he started picking up some bad habits, and he wanted to change. So my son right now, he invited me somewhere tonight, but I thought it was important for me to be here because I raised my children. But it's time for me now to support my community because I want to give back to my community, and I don't want to see no more firearms and no more bullying, no more firearms and no more drugs to move into my residence. Because when you see something, you say something. You stand up for it. And what you're willing to die for, you stand up for it. Or you're willing to lay down for anything. So stand up for what you're willing to die for, because you can't hear what you don't feel. Because if you felt what's really going on in this community, you'll stand up and you do something about it. I didn't drive my car today. I caught the bus because I wanted to see what it felt like to be around, walk around my community. You know how many police officers I seen going down First Avenue? I was waiting on the 901 bus, and I waited at least a half an hour, and I seen at least five police officers going southbound, at least six police officers going northbound. I was like, wow. How many police? We really have a good police presence around here. And I just want to say, I thank God for the police officers of Federal Way. I used to work up here at the mall, at the Commons Mall. I was a security officer, and I know the police officers up there, and they were doing an excellent job. So we can't blame the police. Sometimes we just have to stand up as a community, and we have to say something. We see something, we have to say something. I did have to address some kids in my community, and I had to stand outside my door, and I'd say, you hit her? You better not hit her, or I'm going to call the police. And sometimes, you know what? I might not call the police, but I'm going to stand there until they move, and the police will come by. And I will let them know, yeah, it was them right there. Yeah, he was talking to him right there. He was involved, too. Sometimes you have to see something. Even if it doesn't mean nothing, it's not something, you just have to say something because you never know. You just never know. Let it hit your family, like what this family is going through. But you can't hear what you don't feel, so get out sometime and catch the bus. Get out sometime and walk the park. Get out sometime and be seen so your community will know that they're safe in their own community. Thank you, Mayor Farrell.
Thank you, Sheila. We have State Representative Linda Kochmar. Linda, can you come on up? And then we've got Allison Johnson.
Thank you very much, Mayor Farrell. I really want to say I've lived in this community, raised six children in this community. I've lived here for as long as Greg Vickers' family has lived here, over 40 years. I'm proud to have been part of this council, that you're living in a beautiful community. If you don't think that's not true, just look right out that window at that beautiful greenery and the beautiful scenery we have down at Puget Sound. You're sitting in a beautiful city hall that's paid for. But what I want to say to you, what is really beautiful about this community is the people. Yeah. And that is what has been always beautiful about this community, is that you are willing to be here tonight, overflow crowd into the downstairs area, two other rooms downstairs, that you are willing to step forward, be heard, and get involved. And Mayor, I want to say to you, if you do your PAC, I've already been sort of texting some of your council members with some ideas, but some things I haven't texted yet. What I'm working on in the state, Carol Fraley is right. We don't have strong gun laws for children. We have people in the legislature who have really, really good hearts. They think children need more counseling. I raised six kids. One strike, you're out. there wasn't any. I'm sorry, that's my philosophy. And of course, they had one strike, but they always thought that they were going to get it. But you know, the thing is we do have four teenagers. If you have a gun and you hold up a 7-Eleven, you get a slap on the wrist. This Norm Mailing told me this. Dan Satterberg said the same thing.
Yeah.
King County prosecutors. Second time, slap on the wrist. Third time, same gun, same kid, slap on the wrist. Fourth time, maybe some jail time. Fifth time, maybe then you get jail time. We reduced that last year with a bill to four times you're out. That's not good enough. That's not good enough, but I need help. I need help. If we're going to change the law, I'm one person out of 147. If you want to change the laws in the state, I need the city with your task force to tell me what you think can be changed. Create the bill. I'll sponsor it. The other two, your other representative, Terry Hickel, and your state senator, Mark Malosha, will do the same. We will get that bill passed, or we'll die trying. But what I want to say to you, we need to do that. We need to, there's some things I'm working on. We've talked in this council for years about the children that are couch surfing. I am totally amazed at hearing that children are going to our schools with guns in their backpacks. How come that's happening? What can we do to change that? You need to address that issue. I don't know if we need to have armed officers, not armed, but uniformed officers in the junior highs. I don't know. We've got liquid heroin out there. It's cheaper than pot. Personally, I'm trying to work on something with the state, with the homeless, which we've had homeless teenagers in our communities for years. They couch surf. They get kicked out of their home or they leave their home. Whether or not it's drug-related or not, alcohol-related or not, but what's happening is they need help, and they need mentors. We need more mentors in the communities and service program through the elementary schools on up. But you know what? We need a program for kids. They're kids. Those last three victims were in their 20s, mid to late 20s. We need mentors for children from 18 to 24, and I can say they are children from 18 to 24. We don't have an entry-level job program for these kids. They can't get jobs. You know what? They're selling guns. They're getting on Craigslist. They're selling pot. What we need to do, I want people who have children that are having problems, contact my office. You can walk to my office in Federal Way from this city hall. I have one in Olympia, and I have one here. We have apprenticeship programs. We just put $15 billion, with a B, into a state transportation packages. They're crying for apprenticeships. They're crying. They will take people out of jail that have gotten out of jail. And you know how difficult it is to get a job, even if you haven't been in jail. But you come to my office. I will get you in touch with people. I talked to some this morning, several union people, that will help them get into the apprenticeship programs in the construction trades. So, Mayor, I offer that to you. Please work with my office. Let me help you. And I look forward to the recommendations for your task force. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much, Linda. Allison Johnson.
Thank you, Mayor Farrell. I love that I get to go after the representative. I moved here 3 years ago from the Bay Area, California. So, like my neighbor, you know, I came from a community that was far gone in these types of events. I'm a state social worker here, and I have a special needs adopted daughter who walks these streets every single day. When I found out that she was where she wasn't supposed to be one day, I had to explain to her that you can walk the streets of our city and be killed. And if I don't know where she is, that's very scary. A quick Google search that I did in the back will show you that we do have a fairly adequate number of police officers, and I think that they're doing an amazing job. What I didn't see when I got here, I saw a million people. I saw people that are grieving unnecessarily, but I didn't see any sign-up sheets. I didn't see any place for someone to sign up, like my neighbor, and do something. And she signed up. When she stands outside of her neighbor, outside of her house, and says, "Be gone, and I'm gonna stand here until you are gone," she's signing up to do something. So this meeting, while beautiful and loving, and there's an outpouring of emotion involved, it's great. It's great to see that it's happening, but I need to see sign-up sheets. People are all looking at you to fix the problem, and the seven of you, eight of you, are not going to fix this problem. We truly do need sign-up sheets at all of these events so people can say, "I'm not going to just come to a meeting. I'm going to do something. I'm going to participate in my local Democratic or Republican meetings, or do whatever your school board." Federal Way has treated my daughter like gold, the school district, and I am very blessed to be here. But we need everyone here and everyone that's already left, because there's lots of people that have left, to have the opportunity to do something other than come to a meeting, to sign up to do something. So what I suggest, or what I would like to see, is that you guys figure out what we need to do and the rest of us sign up.
Thank you, Allison. Actually, for everyone that that gave us a pink sheet, we've got their got your contact information as well. Thank you. Yeah, you did. Thank you very much. Was there anybody else who'd like to say something? Anybody else? Yeah, go ahead, Sheila. Can you just approach a comment over the podium? Then we've got another speaker. And then could we have the person in the back that's going to speak? Come on up. Go ahead.
Thank you, Mayor. I just want to say that I looked around the room and I see all these people here today. And I just want to say to the families that lost loved ones, my condolences to you all. But this is not a gun issue. This is not a drug issue, and it's not a Section 8 issue. It's a heart issue. For somebody to go out and kill somebody they don't even know, that person just don't have a conscience. And it's a heart issue. But when I look around the room and see all these people standing here, how many churches are like this? How many buildings are like this where we can come together and stand, like the person said, we a people. We stand as a nation. When you're standing as a nation, you unified. It's hard to break down when you're unified. When you're together, walking together, saying, "I'm going to stand up for my community. I'm going to stand up for what's right." It takes more than one person. It takes a community. It takes somebody to say, "You know what? I'm going to watch out for your kid." We need people here to stand here tonight to be parents to these young people that's bringing up young people. They don't know what to do. And a lot of times, I watched people come up here and give their comments. We're in another day. We're in another time. Back there, that might have helped back there, but we're in a new day now. We got five-year-olds that will kill you, that will shoot you dead and won't blink. But you know what? That just goes to show you, why aren't our libraries looking like this? Do we bring our kids to the library? We got three libraries in Federal Way. They don't have half as many people in there as what they do here, and they stay open at least to 9 o'clock at night. But bring your family and your friends and your neighbors and your coworkers to the house of God. You know, bring them out to church or something so they can get something to help them throughout the week. Because you know what? It's tough out there. It's tough out there for these single mothers. It's tough out there for these people trying to raise families. It's tough out there for people as married, people trying to keep it together. You know?
Okay,
so it's a hard issue.
Thanks, Sheila.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Mayor.
Very much. All right. Please. Would you tell us your name?
My name is Esther Patrick.
Hi, Esther.
Hi. I have lived in Federal Way for 31 years now, and I left
California and came here because of a lot of things that are happening in Federal Way right now. And as much as I appreciate our police department, I've had communication with our chief of police several times for incidents that have gone on in Federal Way and with you. And as much as I really, really appreciate our police presence, I don't want to live in a police state. I want to see some solutions to what we're having with the problems with the violence and the activities that are going on in Federal Way, some type of a moratorium with all of these apartment complexes going up. And I agree with you, whoever it was that said, we need to do something about it rather than just being here talking about it. Right. So I want to know what the solutions are and how can we reach those solutions.
That's right.
I want to live in a safe environment. I'm not safe. If I could sell my home, I'd leave. I would leave Federal Way and I would not be here. But I'm stuck because I'm a homeowner. And my neighborhood is going down. The city of Federal Way was a wonderful place to live, and it's not anymore. Well, it's not for me.
Okay.
And it's not for a lot of us, or else we wouldn't be here right now.
We're here to make it better. That's right. All right. Thank you, Esther. Okay. Anyone else that would like to speak? Have you already spoken?
No.
Oh, come on up, and please tell us your name.
My name is Ventress Smith. I live on 333rd, about 100 feet away from the first killing there. I heard the noise that night. But I've been in Federal Way for 23 years, and I always thought the worst part of that community or that block was on Pack Highway and 333rd, where there's drug dealers and prostitutes. But when they put a park in there 8 years ago, Cedar Grove Park, that's when trouble hit my community. And me and my neighbors, we stood together. We had drug dealers going on at the parks, and loud music on Friday and Saturday nights. But I'd like to thank the Federal Way Police Department because they was there every time we needed them. We had homeless people come in, drug dealers there. The cops was always there when we had trouble. And I really like to thank them. But I think what happened Monday night, no cop could have prevented that. No one could have been there at that hour that happened. And that's, I think Federal Way still is a nice place to live. No matter what goes on there, I would never move. But I would like to see the city do something about 333rd Street. When you go down to the end near the freeway, I would like some speed bumps or something to deter the people from coming through there. It's like a drag strip. You got car dealership there, people test drive the cars. People drive, we had many accidents there. People coming around the corner running into the homes and trees in our neighborhood. So I would just like to see the city do something about our street and put bumps there for the kids crossing the park to the park there. That's a pretty dangerous area because they use that as a speed race. So that's all I ask the city to do is to do something about our street.
Very good. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Appreciate it. All right, Chief, let's follow up on 333rd. All right, in regard to follow up in regard to individual, Chief, there's been a question raised in regard to standards per 1,000 people or whatever the standards are about the number of officers in our community that we've got currently budgeted 131. Where does that rank in regard to, or where does that rate in regard to national standards or for what your knowledge?
We have in our city, about 1.4 officers per 1,000 residents. And we've maintained that ratio for a number of years since the formation of the police department. In terms of per 1,000, that'll vary from community to community, depending on the needs of the community. So although that's what we maintained over the years, that's not always the best standard to use for communities to communities. It all depends what the needs are. So. Some communities have, you know, 3 officers per 1,000 residents. Some have less. So what I could tell you that historically that's what we've maintained to try to keep our community safe. It's about around 1.4 per 1,000 residents.
Okay. All right. There was a question regarding gang activity. And there was a mention that even the signs that we put up to make sure people got here to this meeting, that there had been some immediate tagging, and I know there had been some questions and concerns regarding either a formalized gang activity of known gangs or more loosely associated gangs. Can you tell us what you know about that and what we do at the City of Federal Way in regard to our gang detective and gang unit?
Sure. We have gang members living in our community. I think it's very difficult to quantify and measure, because one day you're a gang member, one day you're not. So I would tell you that we're very proactive. In terms of gangs claiming territory, we don't have that. We work very hard with our gang detectives. We participate regionally, and we do not want gangs to get a foothold. But it's a constant work in progress, and it is really difficult to quantify and measure exactly how many gang members you have. I would tell you it's in terms of population, in terms of ratio, I would say it's a small number.
And are we working regionally with our other law enforcement partners in the South Sound region regard to gang task force units?
Yes, all the time. Regional intelligence, regional meetings. We do need to collaborate. Criminals move from one jurisdiction to another. They don't know boundaries.
Okay. Chief of Staff Brian Wilson, in regard to, there was a question regarding a building moratorium regarding multifamily housing. Could you just briefly touch on, there was a question I said we would follow up. Could you just briefly touch on that and what that it would either entail or what the parameters are or what the status of anything like that would be?
Yes, Mr. Mayor. As of late, the city has actually commissioned a study to take a look at all of the properties within the City of Federal Way that could be developed in a multifamily or complex. We know exactly where those properties are. We've done an assessment of our inventory of housing throughout the city, and even taking a look at the three new projects that have come on board, which is Park 16, Kitts Corner, and then the new complex that's at 320th. With all of our housing stock, we have for tax increment financing and those that are subsidized in some form or another, that represents 7% of our housing within the City of Federal Way. That number is comparable to some of our neighboring jurisdictions, that particular number. But we are looking very closely. The feedback that's come back today is some of the issues that we're taking a look at in terms of what are the criteria that must be met for these to occur in the future? What avenues do we have for design standards and criteria for new types of projects that come online? That is something that's being reviewed by our Community Development Department, and we're committed to working to address the concerns with the growth of and make sure that the housing that we have meets the community's needs.
All right, thank you, Brian. Lastly, Chief Wong, there was a question by one of the speakers in regarding to our the police department working with the apartment complexes, be them the new ones at Park 16 or Kitts Corner, or other apartment complexes. Can you tell us the working relationship and the interaction with those?
Sure. We our crime analyst prevention specialist unit. We have two staff members within that unit, and we work very closely with the property management, and we also provide training to property management staff. We give certification training, and we send police reports regularly to the property management. When we identify potential problem tenant, we work towards a problem solving to address those issues. So I think we have a very successful program, and it's work in progress.
All right, thank you. All right, now we've reached the point where it's a city council discussion on public safety. Council member Maloney, you want to go
you.
First. And then,
yep.
Council, if you are interested in speaking, please turn on your light and I'll call on you in the order that I notice you. Councilmember Maloney.
Thank you. And I just want to first express my personal sympathies to the families who lost their loved ones, and especially to the Gutierrezes who are, I think they've left, and I don't blame them. but that was a random, senseless random act, and it's something that just is devastating for our community, and my heart goes out to all of those families. I'm not going to restate what everyone said, but I do want to say that I agree with so much of what was said, and a lot of those issues are issues that we here, the council and mayor, have dealt with in the past, but there are no easy solutions. These are systemic problems. And we need to find out, I believe, in a proactive, solution-based way, what the root causes are. There are many, as we all heard. There are so many root causes to these issues. And I do believe that we need to have a community coalition. There's a group of people who's been working on this since the first murder, the Jennings murder, who have been motivated and activated to put together a community coalition in concert with with City Hall, the police department, and there's a whole list here of suggested community organizations, and I'll just list some of them, but please know that this is a comprehensive list. So it has to, it would include, you know, residents, the entities I've already mentioned, school districts, churches, mentoring organizations, businesses, youth groups, hospitals, mental health. I mean, the list goes on, as you can see, because this has to be a multi-pronged approach. I do want to thank there were three parents who came to the city right after the Jennings murder who really, really felt strongly that something needed to be done. And as each subsequent situation happened, and they weren't all murders, there were other situations, as we've heard, drive-bys and things of some of random people as well. And every time something happened, there was more and more people became more concerned. And excuse me, my last count is there's at least 100 people who have communicated in this group that want to really activate. And so I strongly suggest that we do that. The council has talked about that. I did want to make a few quick points, if I can figure out where my notes are here. I think if we are able, I do believe a moratorium on multifamily housing would be a good idea. Until we can figure it out, we have to deal with issues such as the Growth Management Act, what our requirements are there. There are also loopholes that incentivize developers to build multifamily housing more so in Federal Way than in more affluent areas. And for the past 2 years, the city has put on our legislative agenda to try and get those loopholes closed, and we haven't been successful in that. But we are working on it. The current multifamily housing that's going in, that was actually decided 4 or 5 years ago, and they're just now getting built. So the delay, part of that was the recession, and there were other reasons, but that's why you're seeing some stuff going on now. I agree that Section 8 housing, people who live in affordable housing, they are not necessarily the problem. Being poor is not a problem. I grew up poor. My mom's on Section 8 right now. That's not a problem. It's the people, and it's the fact that we do have too much density in our city right now, too many people all of a sudden putting a strain on the infrastructure, the schools, and what have you. So I do fully support looking into a moratorium. Heroin is a huge problem. Guns in schools is huge, as someone mentioned. I do support also potentially looking into a buyback program on that. I do understand from Chief Wong that, you know, we have a gang problem, but it may not be as bad as I think it might be. But I do think that we need to look into that. So, again, there's so much more I could say, but you've said it all so well. Last couple things is I would like to see if we could get a sign-up sheet going quickly for the people who are here who did not speak up before you leave. If you're interested, that would be wonderful. And the last thing
Councilmember
is,
Malone, what was that last point you just made?
Oh, the sign-up sheet. If we could put one, if we could have one circulated or people sign up.
That's a great point, Brian. Can we make sure that we, if anybody, thank you. Well, while you're finishing your comments, let me get that started.
Okay.
Can we have somebody maybe put a sign-up sheet back there? If you didn't speak, and to make sure we capture your name and address, if you want to be involved, and make sure that we have your information. So we'll put some information.
Thank you. Just one more thing. I'm wondering if we need to make a motion to actually put together a comprehensive solutions-based community coalition, like we've been talking about, but actually make it a formal process. I would love to see that happen.
We've got the planning meeting, which I believe you are a part of, on Monday.
Correct.
And we can we don't have anything noticed on the agenda to take action formally tonight.
Okay.
But certainly that's something that at the next opportunity we can get the council to make sure.
So maybe on Tuesday night.
That's right. Okay, we can add that to the agenda to make sure it's formalized. Mm-hmm. That even though we're planning for it now. Uh-huh. That doesn't mean that, you know, it should be a reflection of council will.
Sure.
So let's get that added to the agenda.
Great. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And thank you all for being here. I appreciate it.
Councilmember Duclos, then Councilmember Honda.
Well, I'll just follow up that quickly. It would be nice for the rest of us to know what's going on in
the
planning.
Yeah.
Thank you. I think it's real important that this council work together instead of not knowing what's going on and all of this is happening. I wanted to, first of all, thank you all for coming. And my heart goes out to everyone who has been impacted by this. Especially, it really struck home when the person was walking his dog and was killed. I have a dog that I walk all the time and down by the parks and everything. And it just struck home with me that you can't walk your dog and be safe. You end up dead. I guess my question is, since I chair the Finance Committee, I want to know if we really have enough police that can patrol and get out there. And if not, how many more would it take? And I'm not talking about getting new people and spending months getting them trained and through the academy. I'm talking about maybe hiring police from other police forces on a part-time basis to come in and patrol in black and white our streets so that they know that they're out there and we're watching and we're protecting everybody. We do have some healthy reserve balances as chair of the Finance Committee, and I don't think money should be an object in this particular case. We have something going on here that's out of control, and we as the City of Federal Way, we as the citizens, we as the councils, we need to work together, and we need to take control of our city. We're not going to let these people take control of it. We're going to take it back. We're going to get them, and we're going to punish them for what they've done. I think that's all.
All right, Councilmember Duclos. What we'll do is we've got our finance person working on this. We've had these discussions. We've heard this. Certainly, that is something we can run through your committee and make sure we've got presentations before the whole City Council. This is a budget year, but we'll also have conversations.
Let's start before the next budget year. Let's get it going now.
Thank you. Amen. I would note that we actually hired an officer actually this week. Councilmember Honda.
Thank you. I'd like to hire more officers too, but my understanding is that just about every jurisdiction is looking to hire officers, and they're pretty hard to find right now. So I know we are looking to hire more at this point, and we're having a difficult time finding qualified people. Is that correct?
Chief, can you talk a little bit about the delays with the academy and what it takes to get from the time that we hire an officer to the time that we actually get an officer on the street?
Sure. We have plenty of people applying to become police officers. I would say that our agency has very high standards, and a lot of times applicants are washed out during that background process, and it's very competitive market out there right now. So having said that, once we do bring someone on, there is a waiting time at the academy right now. We just hired an officer this week, and the officer will go to the academy maybe August or September of this year. Then the training is about 5.5 months training, and then when they come back, they also have about 4 months of training, field training program. So It is quite an investment from a date of hire to putting an officer on the street. So it's pretty extensive. As far as a lateral pool, we just instituted a bonus for lateral officers to entice experienced officers to come to our city. So we have an incentive program now to bring a lateral officer. So we're working hard. Our administrative section is working very hard to do that. So we will continue to hire. We will continue to hire entry-level and lateral officers to augment our department.
May I say something?
Yeah, Councilmember Duclos.
There may be police officers in other cities that might want to work evenings and come over. So I'm saying there might be police officers that are already out there in other cities that might want to do some evening work or off-hours work to earn some other money, and they could step in right away instead of waiting to go through the academy and everything. I want to beef up our police force, but this way we could hire people right now. In the next couple of weeks, we could at least talk to other cities' police force. If somebody would like to put in a couple of hours a night or 5 hours a night or something, we could bring them on. They're already trained.
Right, that is the benefit of lateral hires. Thank you. Councilmember Honda, you had some more questions?
Thank you. If 1.4 officers to 1,000 residents is what the city has had since we became a city, perhaps it's time that we look at increasing that. What? Excuse me?
Oh. Go ahead.
Okay. Perhaps it's time we look at increasing that. It seems like the council's behind increasing that, and maybe we need to find out what the magic number is that we need. I also, a lot of people tonight came, and I really appreciate people coming out tonight and spending as long as you have here and talking to us and telling us what you're thinking. It's one of the reasons I wanted a special meeting tonight. We heard a lot about schools tonight, and we heard a lot about children in schools, schools that are overcrowded, schools that don't have counselors, children misbehaving in school. And since I've been on this council, I had thought that it would be a great idea to have a combined meeting of our school board and the city council so that we can sit in the same room and we can talk about the issues in the city of Federal Way, because we're two different boards. We're across the street from each other. We're trying to do a lot of the same things. And I believe that if we could sit face to face and have a great a meeting where we could hash out ideas together, find out what they would like us to do, what we would like them to do, I think it would be very beneficial to our city. I'd also, the task force on violence, I'm very glad that it's gonna happen, and I'm hoping that everyone who wants to be on it can be on it. And it was very clear tonight that this is a community, that this is a community that wants to come together, and that this is a community that's willing to work together to make Federal Way an even better place to live. So thank you for coming tonight.
Thank you, Susan. Brian, you've sent me a note. Can you help me clarify about this issue about overtime and about office coverage?
I wanted to say that, you know, under your direction and what's happened, especially to address the safety and concern within the community and following these major crimes that have occurred, is that the mayor's office and all of our departments are in full support of the police department to giving them whatever resources they need to accomplish the mission that's at hand here to identify the people who are responsible for this. And that includes having patrols, additional patrols in neighborhoods, in multifamily areas, in areas that are of concern from our residents. And we're certainly hearing from our residents about that. So there are issues from a staffing level. We have to be very careful about bringing organizations, or officers, just putting them out in our streets. We do have a great mutual aid program that's present with officers. We are in contact with our neighboring jurisdictions, Tacoma, King County, all of our neighboring South County cities. You know, we're committed to whatever resources are necessary to address this issue. I also wanted to mention from Councilmember Honda's comments that as part of the planning that's taking place, and this will be a public forum, task force, you know, whatever the term, we will have the school district and representation of the school board as a part of this process as well. That planning has already taken place or is in process. So,
right.
What I, Well, what I would like to suggest, and I've wanted this to do this for a while, is to have the school board and the city council sitting next to each other.
Yes.
And I think it's time to do that because we're at a very interesting point in Federal Way where our schools are really crowded. We have a lot of new kids coming in, and we don't have space for them. And they've got concerns with us, and I would like to see some things done too. So if we could, that's what I'd like to see. But I'm glad that we are moving in that direction.
All right, thank you. Councilmember Moore.
Actually, I just had a question to the chief. I just heard you mention that we just now started having signing bonuses. Have we had that before up until now?
When the market gets very competitive, we have done it in the past as an organization. But we're not the only one to offer hiring bonuses. There's other law enforcement agencies in the region that's doing that as well.
And you said you've done in the past. So we've done in the past and we've stopped and now we're doing it again? Or have we been always doing it throughout the period of time?
We've done it, stopped it, and we've just instituted it again.
Okay. And Mr. Mayor, I'll have my comments a little bit later and I'll...
You bet.
There's a reason why I'm mentioning that. Thank you.
You bet. I just reapproved that. There was another agency that was putting out a pretty sizable, and we're not going to get into which agency, but a fairly close agency was putting out a sizable bonus out there for signing. And to be competitive in the market to make sure we get good officers, I made the decision and authorized that. Council, are there any other comments? Councilmember Kopang, yep. And then the deputy mayor.
I moved to Federal Way with my parents in 1976, and kind of wanted to move from Redondo Beach, LA. And one of the funny memories that I have as a sixth grader was having a lady come knock on the door and spend about a half hour with my mom. And I got done with the conversation. I said, "Mom, who is that?" She says, "Oh, she's with a welcome wagon." And she explained to me what that meant. I mean, this is kind of from a bygone era, but the thing is, as a sixth grader, moving to a community, I connected with that. I connected with the fact there was somebody here in Federal Way that was happy to see me, a guy from LA, or my family, move here and be a part of our community. I felt welcomed. And as I listened tonight, I really was encouraged that I think sometimes things are said and they can kind of go in a different direction than they were intended. And I think we saw that tonight. But regarding the welcoming nature of our community, I think that still continues this day. And I think that, you know, when we look at the apartments that are coming in, we have seen some increases in police activity as a result of the actions there. That's happened. But the thing is by talking negatively about it, what are we really accomplishing? We're dividing our community. And I think it's very important, especially in a time of tragedy, for us to come together, for us to look at solutions that not only address the issues, but really in addressing the issues, bring to the togetherness that we need. And we're talking about a coalition or a task force, whatever we end up calling it. I think that's a very important thing. It's about the community being engaged. And as a member of the council, I want to provide that opportunity for those of you that want to be engaged. I want it to be productive. I want it to be to have the backing of the city, and I want it to move us forward in becoming a city that is unified in addressing the issues that happen. I think that it's very important for us in taking action to make sure that it's action that is going to yield a benefit. And I think one of the things that we're looking at right now is what actions can we take, and what are the benefits of those actions? And that's part of the analysis that we're going through. But I can tell you, as a member of the council, I'm committed to action. I'm committed to doing what we need to do. I also served on the Civil Service Commission for 4 years, and really appreciate the work that commission is doing in assisting our police department in finding in bringing qualified applicants to our city for the police department to hire. I sat on that commission with some frustration, knowing that we had numbers that we wanted to hit as far as hiring was concerned. And it was, you want to make it happen fast. You want to make it happen. And as a member of the commission, I unfortunately had to be a firsthand witness to how difficult it can be to hire qualified officers that meet our qualifications. And we don't hire police officers for a year. We really want to hire them for the rest of their career. And we don't always get that benefit, but we really want to bring the right people into our community. Again, we're not looking at, you know, we're looking at really having a police department that is a part of Federal Way, that fits with Federal Way. And I think when we look at police enforcement, we can look at, you know, just taking care of the issue, getting people in here, but we want the right people so that this community feels protected, this community feels honored, and they know that they are getting the help that they need when, in fact, they do need help. I liked a lot of the ideas I heard tonight, and I wanted to thank all of you that spoke up. You know, I look at, you know, as a member of the council, you know, we have ideas, but I really recognize that there is really some genius in this room. And by working together, by really being unified in searching for solutions, we're going to find the solutions we need as a city. So I'm really encouraged that in a time of tragedy, we can come together and have a very civil and substantive conversation about the future of a city that we all love. So I just appreciate everyone that came here tonight and for the time they spent and for the energy that they expended to be a part of the solution here tonight. So thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Deputy Mayor Burbidge.
Thank you very much. I want to express my appreciation as well for all of you who came here tonight and shared your very honest concerns, your recommendations, your passions for the community, and your worries about the community, about the future for all of us. My husband and I have lived in Federal Way, in the Federal Way area, because we haven't been a city until 26 years ago, for 47 years. We raised our three children here. We loved it from the very beginning. We continue to love it. And we are very optimistic about our city. We know that, however, that success does not come necessarily easily, and it doesn't come without effort. I was also very encouraged to hear the passion and the willingness to step forward by so many tonight, and the themes that were expressed, the themes of working together on solutions, of stepping up. And when it comes to particular solutions, we've had success with some particular ways of addressing problems in the past, and I would like to see some of those combined and improved upon and expanded. A couple of those are the very traditional neighborhood watch programs or block watch programs. Those can be stepped up, they can be increased. And we've built on that kind of effort with the Safe City program. That was initiated as a program to address concerns more in the downtown and commercial areas with cameras, and those have been very useful in solving crimes and preventing crimes. But we've also expanded the Safe City program to a lot of the neighborhoods where the homeowners associations have gotten involved. People have shared their email addresses so people can be in touch with each other more quickly. All times of the day and night, you can send an email without interrupting somebody's sleep or interfering with what they're doing. But then when they look at their email, that message is there and they know that somebody has a concern. And those emails then can also be shared with our police department. And of course, this is a voluntary participation. But it has been very effective. It has actually resulted in reducing residential crime rates very significantly. So I encourage all of these efforts. There are so many ways that our city can work with the whole community to achieve improvements and to address the fears, all of the concerns. But it does take the whole community working together. And I see that commitment this evening. I see it from the folks who came to the meeting. I hear it from our council, our mayor, our staff. We have some pretty impressive abilities when we all get together and work on it as a city, as a community, as a whole. So thank you again.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor Burbidge. Councilmember Moore.
Thank you. Thank you for being here. Thank you for it's approaching 9:45 now, and I appreciate seeing many people here. Oftentimes, this chamber is empty at 9:45, So thank you for making the commitment and caring for your city. There's a lot to be said. I appreciate everything that's been said from my colleagues. It's clear that we have a great council that's working together and resolving this issue of making our community safe. Thank you to you and what you've said. I've been in absolute awe of everything that's been shared, and I'm truly inspired by it. And I think we should all be inspired by what's being said. Like Councilmember Copain said, I'm also focused on action, focused on results. And the things I'm going to be working on in the future, because one member said it here earlier, and that's while we need to be focused on right now and today, we also need to be focused on the future. I'm going to be looking at adding more officers. That is, as a policymaker and as a person that votes on the budget, that is the request I have. I want to see more police officers. I think, like our chief said, the fact that we have 1.4 officers per 1,000, that number is interesting. And the fact that we've had that for a very, very long time, times are changing. Population has grown, right? And so I'm looking forward to working through our committee and through our budget committee. I look at Mark because I know he's on the public safety committee. So I'm looking forward to analyzing that and find out what should that number be.
Don't forget FedRAC is the money.
Yeah, exactly. And I also said in the FedRAC committee as well, where I vote on many financial aspects, and that's something I'm going to be looking at. Secondly, while there's been so much that's been said, I am convinced that part of the root causes are drugs. That is it, amongst others. And I'm interested to find out how can we partner up and how do we become effective partners, I should say, in fighting the war on drugs. Because I think that really is the answer. In everything I've read, it stems from that, at least in the shootings and in the crimes that we've had here in Federal Way. Secondly, I used to be part of the Federal Way Public Schools AmeriCorps team. And Monda Holsinger, who used to be the director of the program, she did a lot for our community in providing for a safer community through innovative programs like AmeriCorps and other groups that brought our youth together. And I know just on my Facebook, she stated that this is a gain issue. And so I recognize that our gains might have gone down or relatively small, but I also would like to take a look at that and find out how do we get rid of our gains. And secondly, I've known my mentor since I was 16 years old, and it's Senator Mark Melosha. And one of the things that he's always one of the things he's always talked about is the issue to crime is the fact that our parenting. We need to have strong families. We need to have strong parents, and we need to have parents that are engaged. Yes. And I know that my fiance is part of the early learning department, and I hear stories all the time. And we need that to happen. So, to my colleagues, you're definitely right. We need to team up. And I know that I've talked to our school board president, Jeffrey McEnalloy, in making sure that we can all come together and start meeting more frequently together. And I think that's what I would also like to see. I know that when I was running for office, my solution for public safety was knowing your neighbor. I heard that earlier. And I think that's something that we also need to be engaged with. We've all heard the Safe City program. If you like it or not, I recognize for the people that may not like it, but it works. And I've met with our commander for the Safe Cities chief. Who's the commander?
Commander
Chris Norman.
Norman.
Thank you, Commander Norman. I've met with him. That program works. I've seen it from the inside, and it's effective. Calling your neighbors, getting to know who your neighbors are, that works. And I'm going to stop with that because you guys know where I'm headed with that. And I love the fact that what Representative Kochmar said, apprenticeships, that's something that we've all been talking about here. We've given apprenticeship programs for the Performing Arts and Conference Center. So part of the panhandling, I hear you loud and clear. That's something I see that every single day. My friend and I, we drive and we count how many panhandlers we see out there. Part of that, as I've proposed and I've talked to my colleagues, is and I know that Albuquerque, New Mexico is doing this, let's hire those people. I know I've talked to some people in the audience about that, because the one way to get them off the street is offer them a job and keep them busy. I know that, that's something I want to look at. There are a lot of solutions, and we have them in this room, and I'm looking forward to the future. I know that we are a community that comes together. We are a beautiful community, and we have a lot of intelligent people in our community. So let's put all those minds together. Let's work towards making our community a safe place. And I'm in it in the long term. I know that I'm just got accepted to a university program to start studying, getting my master's in middle school counseling. And I know that in our schools, that's where we have a lot of issues. And I'm looking forward to being part of the solution through that avenue later on. So thank you for your time. Thank you for being here. And my cell phone's on the website. Give me a call if you want to talk this through. I'm ready and able to listen. Thank you.
I speak for everybody on this dais and for everybody in this community. Thank you so much for taking the time, not just the people that are here, but we're in the other rooms, for speaking on behalf of your fellow citizens who maybe couldn't be here tonight. We really appreciate your comments. It was very important. We'll continue this work. Let's continue this dialogue. You're going to see actions, not just words. You're going to see a lot of actions. We've got a great police department. But I think this was a triumph of democracy tonight. And this was a great conversation. What's most important is that it's followed up in deed and action. And that we will, and you'll see that. So thank you very much. With that, the hour is late, and we are adjourned.